There will be other important issues on your ballot. Here to break down the biggest initiatives across the country is the managing editor of the Washington Free Beacon, Aaron McLean. Aaron, good to see you this morning. Thanks for waking up for us.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
All right. So as I said, you know, we've talked so much about the general election, but who is going to control the Senate is at stake. And currently, Republicans are trying to hold on to 24 seats, some of them in swing states. What's going to happen here?
Look, this is unforgiving math. Long before Donald Trump was the nominee or either party had a nominee, Republicans knew that the Senate math in 2016 was unforgiving. You have them defending something like 24 seats, with Democrats only defending, I think the number is 10. And all Democrats really need to do is to pick up 4 seats and win the presidential race. Wow. To give them control of the Senate, or of course 5 seats would take control even with a Republican win. That is a very doable task for them, and Republicans face some extremely tight races, places like Illinois, Wisconsin, a bunch of others.
And Nevada, Harry Reid seat, that'll be interesting to see what happens there. All right, so Obamacare is obviously on people's minds across the country, but in Colorado, for example, health care is something they're going to be voting on.
Yes, that's right. Supporters of a initiative, I think it's Proposition 69 in Colorado, say that Obamacare is leaving too many people uninsured, and so they need statewide single payer, essentially universal health care for Coloradans. It's a very bold plan. The initiative would cost more than the current operations of the state of Colorado. There'd be a huge tax increase to fund it. This has actually been tried before a few years ago.
Vermont gave us a shot. How did that play out for them?
Not well. I mean, do you remember Green Mountain Care?
Right?
You probably don't. Nobody really does. People gave it up in Vermont when they realized how much it was going to cost.
We'll see how that plays out. And gun control in a number of states is on the ballot.
Yeah, that's right. This is kind of an interesting fact about the gun control initiatives that are out there in California, a couple other states. They're all gun control initiatives. That is to say, they're not too many gun rights initiatives. California has a large capacity magazine initiative, banning large capacity magazines on the ballot. Washington's got an initiative relating to domestic violence and protective orders and who can have a gun under those circumstances. These are all looking pretty good in terms of their prospects for passing.
And the minimum wage in places like Arizona going up $10, Colorado $12, Maine $12, Washington $13.50. How does that play out, and how should people be thinking about that as they're voting on it?
Well, look, this is an emotional issue. This is one of those situations when you're there in the voting booth, and it seems like a minimum wage increase is going to help low-income voters. But of course, economists will point out that when the government raises the price of labor, employers buy less of it. It's simple supply and demand. So things that are often well-intentioned and seem like they're going to help low-income workers may end up actually reducing the number of jobs out there. If you see all those self-checkout lanes in grocery stores, that kind of automation, that thing is spurred by higher minimum wages.
It's so interesting. Sometimes all these important issues get lost during a general election, but you got to keep your eye on them. We'll see how all of this plays out. Aaron, good to see you this morning. Thanks for being here.
Thanks so much.
And South Dakota proposing a minimum wage decrease from $8.50 to $7.50.
Yeah.
Voting on that. Well, the time now is 19 minutes after the top of the hour. The battle in the Buckeye State, Donald Trump holding a slight lead in the all-important state of Ohio.
But can he keep it? Well, we'll take you live there next. Stick with us. In the battle for the White House today, both campaigns sending surrogates to the must-win state of Ohio.
Donald Trump holding a slight lead in the Buckeye State after more than a million early ballots have already been cast.
And that is where we find Matt Finn, who is live in Columbus this morning. Matt, good to see you.
Good morning, Abby and Heather and everyone at home. Well, this morning, the average of polls now shows Donald Trump ahead by 2.5 points here in the critical state of Ohio. And Hillary Clinton is unleashing some of the biggest weapons in her arsenal to make a dent in that lead. President Obama campaigned here in Ohio yesterday. He hammered Donald Trump, but avoided mentioning perhaps the biggest threat facing Hillary Clinton's presidency. And that's the FBI Director James Comey's decision to publicly renew the probe into her private email server. President Obama told the crowds here in Ohio, Hillary is not a liar.
Has she made mistakes? Of course, so have I. There's nobody in the public arena over the course of 30 years that doesn't make some. But she is a fundamentally good and decent person who knows what she's doing and will be an outstanding president.
In these final days, ground game is considered crucial, especially since Donald Trump's lead is well within most margins of error. Clinton and the Democrats have had a very visible ground game here. Trump, well, not so much support. Ohio's own governor, John Kasich, publicly announced Monday he voted for John McCain on his absentee ballot. Looking ahead today, Eric Trump will be campaigning on behalf of his father at two separate events in Ohio. Abby and Heather, back to you.
It's an important state. All right, Matt Finn, live for us in Columbus. Thank you, Matt.
Everyone has their families out trying to support
doing
them.
Anything they possibly can. Yeah. They need them.
Well, the time now is 25 minutes after the top of the hour, and Clinton is in serious trouble. That is a quote, and it's a grave new warning from a well-known internet pirate. Are her 33,000 deleted emails about to be released?
And how one phone call from former President Bill Clinton earned the Clinton Foundation $6 million. We're going to take you inside the new WikiLeaks dump.
And first, though, Jimmy Kimmel's sixth annual. This is always funny. Parents tell their kids that they ate their Halloween candy.
There's no more left. You're just joking.
No, I ate it all.
We ate all your Halloween candy.
And I ate all your candy.
It is Wednesday, November 2nd, 6 days now until Election Day, and it is a sprint to the finish.
Can't believe it's 6 days. Donald Trump putting a 1-2 punch on his closing argument as Hillary Clinton dodges the FBI investigation by unleashing an all-out assault on Trump supporters.
For any Democratic voter, you are having a bad case of buyer's remorse. You can change your vote to Donald Trump. We'll make America great again, okay?
I am sick and tired of the negative, dark, divisive, dangerous vision and behavior of people who support Donald Trump.
Woo! Well, we are live as the candidates double down in key battleground states today, making their final push.
Square, where everyone is starting to wake up. Light's always shining there, though.
Everyone's always up in Times Square.
Good morning to you. You're watching Fox and Friends First. I'm Heather Childers.
Good morning. I'm Abby Huntsman. It's currently 31 after the hour, and we begin with 6 days to go in this election. Donald Trump and Mike Pence seizing momentum in the final days of this election.
And the Republican running mates heading to the must-win state of Florida with an anti-Obamacare message that is making America listen.
Kristen Fisher's live for us in Washington, D.C. with the new poll numbers to prove it. Kristen, who would have guessed a week ago the polls would be as close as they are today?
I know, Abby. I mean, there have been so many twists and turns in this race, and it seems only fitting that with 6 days to go, we're looking at a dead heat. Clinton's still ahead by about 2 points in the Real Clear Politics average of polls. But a new poll out yesterday has Trump ahead by 1 point. According to this ABC News Washington Post poll, Trump is at 46%, Clinton's at 45%, Gary Johnson's at 3%, and Jill Stein's at 2%. The last time this poll had Trump in the lead was back in May, 6 months ago. And check this out. Down in Florida, Trump's doing even better. According to this New York Times Siena poll, he's at 46%, while Clinton's 4 points behind at 42%. Now, that's where Trump will be campaigning today. Yesterday, he was in Wisconsin and Pennsylvania, where he was back to ripping on Obamacare. He says if elected, he'll ask Congress to convene a special session to repeal and replace it. He's also asking Democrats who've already voted for Clinton to reconsider. He says that in some states, it's not too late to change your vote if you're experiencing, quote, buyer's remorse after all of these latest revelations about her emails. And Trump also had this message for her campaign chairman, John Podesta. Listen.
Has been caught saying, we have to dump all of those emails. Can you believe this? That's WikiLeaks. John Podesta, I tell you what, if he worked for me, I would fire him so fast. Like The Apprentice, John, you're fired.
I think he's rehearsed that line a few times. Now, in Wisconsin, that's where Trump was just speaking, voters can actually change their minds up to 3 times. Who knew? Apparently, it's rarely ever done, but Abby and Heather, and again, I mean, 2016 seems intent on breaking every single rule that's out there. So maybe some Wisconsin voters will change their minds. They have until Thursday to do so.
Yeah.
Back
right.
to you.
To all those people who called this over months ago, mm-hmm. it's not over till it's
I know.
Over. Just like sports.
And we've certainly learned a lot in this election. Yeah. 7 states, aside from Wisconsin, 7 in all, you can change your vote. Who knew?
Who knew? Thanks, Kristen. That's what Kristen
sure. Thank you.
Was here to tell us this morning. Who knew? All right, well, on the Democratic side, just call her the pivot man. FBI investigation on the trail and instead ramping up attacks on Donald Trump. Jackie Banias is here following the Clinton campaign. Jackie, good morning.
Good morning, Abby. One more week. Hillary Clinton heading to Arizona and Nevada today, where she's in virtual tie with Donald Trump. Right now, a clear, real clear politics poll average shows Trump leading his Democratic challenger by 1.5 points in the red state of Arizona. Stark contrast from 1 week ago, you may remember. And in Nevada, Trump is closing in on Clinton's once more than 5-point lead. He's now trailing by a single point in the swing state. But as the numbers creep closer nationwide, Clinton is coming out swinging. Yesterday in critical Florida, she deflected from her renewed FBI firestorm by pivoting towards Trump's taxes.
Took everything our great country has to offer. He scooped it up with both hands and then paid nothing to support us. And then he has the nerve to call our military a disaster, to insult POWs when he hasn't paid a penny to support the people who put on the uniform of the United States of America. Donald Trump is the poster boy for everything that's wrong with our economy.
She even brought former Miss Universe Alicia Machado on stage, parading the woman Trump once called Miss Piggy around, using her to blast her rival on his treatment of women. And today, Clinton is pulling out a full court press across the U.S. less than 1 week out from Election Day. President Obama, Tim Kaine, Bernie Sanders, Bill, and Chelsea, of course, all tackling the trail for the Democratic nominee. Heather, back to you.
All those swing states, they are so close. Thank you so much, Jackie. We have a brand new warning. WikiLeaks might soon release Hillary Clinton's 33,000 deleted emails. Remember those? Well, this comes as new emails reveal a $6 million foreign donation to the Clinton Foundation. Chief National Correspondent Ed Henry has details on the mad scramble to, quote, dump all the emails.
An explosive new email shows Bill Clinton lined up a cool six. His foundation from Sheikh Mohammed of Ethiopia with a mere phone call. One aide writing, it would be crazy to go all the way to Ethiopia for a conference. Lindsay writes, if the call is made, it will help us get the $6 million. I think he should call. And a newly leaked email from March 2nd, 2015, the night the New York Times revealed Clinton used a private email account as Secretary of State shows, campaign chairman John Podesta wrote Cheryl Mills, not to sound like Lanny, but we are going to have to dump all those emails, so better to do so sooner than later. A reference to damage control expert Lanny Davis, known for urging the Clintons to err on the side of transparency. Except the timeline created by these WikiLeaks disclosures show a far different approach of holding back information, starting with the candidate. When the Times story first crossed on March 2nd, Podesta asked campaign manager Robbie Mook if he had any idea of the depth of it. Mook replied, nope. On March 4th, Republican Trey Gowdy, chair of the Benghazi committee, subpoenaed Clinton's emails. That same day, citing executive privilege, Podesta wrote Mills, think we should hold emails to and from the president? March 7th, President Obama said he learned about Clinton's email system from news reports. Mills writes, we need to clean this up. He has emails from her. They do not say state.gov. That same day, Philippe Reines writes, there is just no good answer for the server.
In Washington, Ed Henry, Fox News.
You know, if you haven't done it yourself, go through some of those WikiLeaks emails because it's amazing.
It really is. Mm-hmm. I spent all day yesterday just reading through them. Really fascinating. All right, the time is now 38 after the hour. And voter fraud alert. Brand new concerns this morning about stolen absentee ballots in one of the biggest battleground states.
And President Obama hitting the trail hard for Hillary Clinton.
We've seen in America that went from too many people uninsured to now 20 million people with health care who didn't have it before.
But what would a Clinton presidency actually look like for your wallet? We're taking a closer look up next.
Well, I don't know.
Welcome back to Fox and Friends. First, a Fox News alert for you. A massive manhunt happening right now in Iowa. That is where two police officers were gunned down in what appears to be a violent ambush-style attack. One officer had been responding to a call about shots fired. This was near a high school just outside of Des Moines around 1 a.m. The other officer responding was ambushed in his patrol car near the scene. So far, no one is in custody. We are expecting to learn more from police in just a few moments, and we'll bring you those details as soon as we have them.
Oh, just so horrible. Mm. Well, just 6 days until the presidential election, and voter fraud is front and center. Thieves are stealing ballot forms from mailboxes and using them to vote. A couple near Orlando who didn't receive their ballots in the mail, they discovered they had already been turned in. Well, the same thing happened to three of their neighbors. Election officials say the fraudulent votes luckily were not counted. And there is no debate. This election has been vicious on the campaign trail, but it's even gotten so heated an elementary school canceled its mock presidential election because students were fighting. The principal at the school in New York saying, quote, teachers heard some kids in the cafeteria chanting Trump, 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 or saying they don't want Muslims here. We have a diverse community here. We want all our students to feel valued. Instead, students will vote for their favorite school lunch instead. Heather.
Thank you, Abby. Well, President Obama hitting the trail hard for Hillary Clinton and hyping the economy that he's overseen for the last 8 years. Listen.
We turned job losses into 15 million new jobs. Poverty went down faster than any time since 1968. We've seen an America that went from too many people uninsured to now 20 million people with health care who didn't have it before.
But is the economic picture really as rosy as the president is painting it? And what will it mean for voters if Hillary Clinton continues his legacy for the next 4 years? Brian Brinberg, he's the chairman of business and finance at the King's College in New York City. And he joins us now to break it all down for us. Thank you for joining us.
Good to be here.
So we heard President Obama painting a rosy picture there. And he did, you know, what, grow the economy, but not necessarily in the correct places.
Well, you know, he's telling part of the story, but you notice what he's leaving out. He's leaving out debt. He's leaving out long-term unemployed. He's leaving out people stuck in part-time jobs. He's leaving out the growth and regulation. That's part of the Obama economy story. If you're not telling that part of the story, you're not telling the whole story.
And the people not looking for jobs anymore because they just
and the growth and the number of people who have dropped out of the labor force. Yeah, so this is it's a very mixed picture at best, and he's just not telling that story in the campaign trail.
But when you hear Hillary Clinton speak about her economic plan, she's got big plans. Let's take a look, first of all, at her wish list. This is everything that she would like to do, and it sure sounds great. $350 billion for tuition-free college, $275 billion for infrastructure, $300 billion for paid family leave, and $60 billion for clean energy. All right, well, that's all great, but how are you going to pay for
it? It's got to come from somebody. Yeah. It's going to come out of somebody's pocket. Clinton says it's going to come out of wealthy taxpayers' pocket. She wants to tax the rich, she says, not middle-class Americans. The problem there is the rich, the wealthy, have capital that they invest in businesses. They have money that they can lend to borrowers to buy homes. And so what happens is when you tax them, you're actually eliminating that capital, drying up capital for the average American, and that hurts the average American. Mm-hmm. The economy as a whole, it's not parts, it's not wealthy against middle class, it's everybody working together. Yeah. But she seems to want to bifurcate it.
Well, let's take a look at those numbers you were just mentioning for the middle class. The estimated cost of a Hillary Clinton presidency for the average middle class citizen, a 1.8 to 2.4% decrease after tax income, and then a $750 cost for a worker with a salary of $36,000 or so a year.
Yeah. These are rough estimates because, of course, the candidates never put out enough detail to really tell with any precision what's going to happen. But the point is Hillary Clinton's not going to grow the economy. She wants to tax the rich and she wants the government to spend more money. As you said, give money to college students, spend more money on health care, but it's not going to grow the economy, which means it's not going to grow investment, it's not going to grow wages, and that's what hits middle-class taxpayers' pocketbooks.
So in order to grow the economy, one of the main things you have to do is have new businesses.
Absolutely. You need to reform taxes, you need to reform regulation. We've had hundreds of billions of dollars $1 trillion of new regulation over the past 8 years. That kills businesses. That makes it hard to start a new business. If you want to put people to work, if you want to grow wages, you have to grow businesses. That means you have to roll back regulation. She wants to go in the opposite direction, and that's one of the real problems with her economic plan.
Yeah, and also she wants to, kind of redo Obamacare, keep Obamacare, and we have all of those costs that are coming out in the news.
Double down on Obamacare, increase the subsidies, introduce a public option. So if you like the way Obamacare is working, if you like the higher premiums, well, you're probably going to see more of that under her plan.
And then also in her plan, what's the other key to growing the economy that we would need to do in order to pay for it?
Well, in her plan just doesn't have growth. She's talking about infrastructure spending as a way to grow the economy. But we've seen that story play out in this country in 2008. We've seen it play out in other countries. It doesn't work. Government stimulus doesn't grow the economy. Private investment does. And the problem right now with Clinton's plan, she's talking about government trying to grow the economy. That's moving in. That's the direction of the last 7 years. We haven't seen the results we wanted to see. We need to move in the other direction.
Yeah, it's like that other phrase for tax increases. Don't want to use that phrase.
No, right.
But it means the same thing. Okay. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Brian. Good to see you, too.
You bet.
Always late to have you. Well, still coming up, we have the other Brian Kilmeade, with what is coming up on Fox and Friends this morning. Good morning to you.
Yeah, and Heather, if negotiations come out well, I'm going to be joined by Angelie and Steve, but we're not going to know to the very last minute. Let me tell you, Heather, a great show as usual, but let me tell you what's straight ahead. 6 days into the election, Karl Rove is here live to map out Donald Trump's potential path to victory, one that wasn't there perhaps a week ago. Lieutenant General Michael Flynn's been doing most of the introducing of Donald Trump on the stump. He's going to be here live. And Kurt Menefee of Fox Sports has a great message. Sometimes you lose in order to win. He's going to be here live, as well as some other special guests. Don't miss a minute of Fox and Friends. Countdown to the most exciting election in the history of man continues.
Well, now to a Fox Business alert. Some brand new State Department documents reveal hackers tried to hit Hillary Clinton's private server nearly a dozen times.
Wow. Cheryl Cassone from our sister network Fox Business here with the latest on that. Cheryl, good morning.
Yeah, good morning. Well, these new documents really show us the complexity of having a private server and the danger of that as well. Now, this email, and we're going to show it to you right now, comes from Brian Pagliano. He was an aide to Hillary Clinton. This newly discovered email written says that basically the failed login attempts on the 27th were for username Doug and Doug Band. The failed login attempts on the 29th were for username Huma. They're trying to figure out who was trying to log into that server. They did have hackers attempting this between November 27th and the 29th back in 2010, but now we're seeing the proof of that. Now, here's what's really key about this. Remember that Director Comey said that there was no evidence that her server had been compromised, but at the same time, with just those 2 days, that 40-hour period with the hackers trying to get into her email server, there's now more questions about, was the data compromised?
A lot of questions. That's what people were concerned about early on with this whole thing. So people have been searching Google all election long, but there's one search that's been hitting an all-time high.
This is interesting. So the phrase, where do I vote early, the amount of times that people are going to Google and searching on that from September to October of this year jumped 3,200%. The top five counties where they were searching were in Texas, but take a look at the states where they were actually searching as well. The top five early voting searches: Maryland, Georgia, North Carolina, Washington, D.C., and Texas. Again, as I mentioned, the top five counties by county were in Texas. But Google Trends saying that that is a very popular topic.
Yeah, we'll see if that translates to more people actually voting early. All right, so there's this new Starbucks cup. A lot of people not voting for it, not in favor of it. It's green.
Yeah, I thought it was the holiday cup when I first saw it, Cheryl.
Yeah, I know. It is confusing, to be honest with you. So this is the Unity cup. Okay, and so Starbucks always comes out with new cups for the holidays, but this is coming out before the election. And the artist that designed the cup says that basically it's to show everyone uniting together. Well, they're getting kind of slammed on social media, especially on Twitter, because they say that the critics say that this is a liberal bias that Starbucks is showing and that they're trying to somehow affect the election. Also, they're saying, where's the holiday spirit in these cups? Even though these cups are coming out before the election, this is when they do their holiday cups at Starbucks. And critics are saying that you're once again insulting Christmas.
But that's not replacing the holiday cup.
No, we still get those, right? Because I wait all year long for the holiday cup.
Yeah, there's going to be a red cup, but there's nothing Christian about the cup. There's nothing that says Christmas. It's very,
very
kind of plain.
Yeah.
And they've been moving in this direction over the last 2 to 3 years. And they're getting hit again.
Well, we have a lot of people that have some comments about that.
We do. Thank you, Cheryl.
Thanks, Cheryl. And those comments pouring in about that Starbucks cup controversy. Marianne on Facebook saying that Starbucks needs to stick to selling coffee and not pushing their political agenda down our throats.
Ooh, Carla says, not fooling me. I know they're supporting crooked Hillary. Daniel says, anti-military, pro-Clinton, pro-Planned Parenthood equals no more caramel fraps for me. Just say no to Starbucks.
And Ezra makes it simple. I don't care as long as the drinks are still good. Thank you for all your comments.
That's a way to round it out.
Yeah, they should be cheaper, though. I don't know.
I agree with that.
Coffee.
All right, almost 5 minutes now, the top of the hour. And brace yourself for some pain at the pump.
What could have gas prices skyrocketing? 1 minute until the top of the hour. Before you leave the house, here's what's happening for you today. A manhunt right now after two police officers are gunned down in an ambush near Des Moines, Iowa. The officers killed 30 minutes apart. One of them was sitting alone in his patrol car.
Gas prices are expected to rise on the East Coast after a deadly gas explosion. A state of emergency now declared in Alabama as crews repair the Colonial Pipeline.
And it all comes down to tonight. The Chicago Cubs forcing the Cleveland Indians into Game 7 in the World Series after a 9-3 win last night. Game time, 8 p.m. Eastern in Cleveland.
It's going to be an emotional one. All right, well, 6 days left, and we are in the home stretch. Hillary Clinton campaigning in Arizona and Nevada today as Donald Trump crisscrosses Florida, pushing his message to voters that there's still time to change your vote. So let's keep talking about that. Would you change your early vote if you could? Weigh in now on our Facebook page with the hashtag #KeepTalking.
In 7 states, you can do that. Who knew? Well, Fox and Friends starts right now.
Have a good day.
Bye.
It is Wednesday, November 2nd. I'm Ainsley Earhart. We start with this, a Fox News alert. It has happened again. Two officers ambushed overnight, shot to death while sitting in their squad cars. This happened in Iowa. Right now, a massive manhunt is underway looking for that shooter. We are following the breaking developments.
It's terrible. Meanwhile, 6 days until the election, Donald Trump issues a challenge to voters who have already cast their ballots.
This is a good time to make an important public service announcement. You can change your vote to Donald Trump. We'll make America great again, okay?
You can if you've early voted in a couple of states. We're going to tell you what we know about that coming up.
Then, if you or your friends support Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton wants to have a talk.
If you know anybody who's thinking about voting for Trump, well, first of all, stage an intervention.
Okay, that's your closing argument. Plus, more details about the investigation into Hillary Clinton's emails. Somebody's been hacking like 10 times. Let me just remind you, wake up, please get dressed. Your mornings are better with friends.
This is a Fox News alert, and thanks for joining us on this very, very busy Wednesday. Heather's got a sad story out of Urbandale, Iowa, which is the western suburbs of Des Moines.
That's right. This news just coming in overnight. It happened about 1 a.m. local time, breaking at this hour. There is a massive manhunt that is now intensifying for a cop killer in that state. Police in Iowa say a gunman targeted two officers in what they describe as violent ambush-style attacks. One officer had been responding to a call about shots fired near a high school just outside Des Moines. The other officer then responding, he was ambushed in his patrol car near the scene. So far, no one is in custody. We are expecting to learn more from police in just a few minutes, and we will bring you those breaking details as soon as we have them. Investigators are hoping that recording equipment can explain what caused this violent and deadly school bus crash. Police in Baltimore say the empty school bus, thankfully for that, zigzagged down the street like a ping pong ball. The bus first plowing into the back of a car before it tore into a city bus with people on board. Six people were killed, including the school bus driver. Police say there were no skid marks, indicating that driver may have had a medical emergency. Well, just hours after decades of disappointment and heartbreak will be washed away for either Chicago or for Cleveland.
of Florida.
That's right. The Republican nominee urging early Clinton voters to recast their ballots in the wake of this latest FBI investigation.
All right, Fox News national senior national correspondent John Roberts is live in Miami with the very latest. Hey, John.
It was close.
I'm just going to give up, Brian. Yeah. Just say here,
we're almost
John.
Done. I got six more days to get it right.
Yeah, there you go. We'll keep trying. Good morning to you, Brian, Steve, Ainsley. It always feels good to be in Florida. Somehow waking up in Miami on the shores of Biscayne Bay is just a wonderful thing. Three numbers, to keep in mind here. 29, 4, and 4,093,000. 29 electoral votes up for grabs. This is the big prize of all of the swing states. Donald Trump leads in a new New York Times Siena poll by 4 points, and 4,093,000 people have already cast early ballots. Today, Donald Trump with a big rally here in downtown Miami at the amphitheater at Bayfront Park. That's going to provide him a very big visual in terms of creating enthusiasm to get people out to vote here in the Sunshine State. Yesterday, a big rally in Eau Claire, Wisconsin, where Donald Trump urged people who have voted for Hillary Clinton in four states where they allow it to change their vote on Election Day. Listen to what he said.
For any Democratic voter who have already cast their ballots for Hillary Clinton and who are having a bad case of buyer's remorse, Wisconsin is one of several states where you can change your early ballot if you think you've made a mistake.
Yeah. Those other states are Michigan, Pennsylvania, Minnesota, by the way. Donald Trump yesterday continued to highlight Hillary Clinton's lingering problems with the FBI investigation. He'll do that again today, but also going deep into policy yesterday with a speech in Valley Forge, Pennsylvania on Obamacare. Of course, he's promised to repeal and replace it, but upping the ante yesterday, saying that he would make this a big priority and would do that through Congress with a very interesting way to do it. Listen to what he said.
I will ask Congress to convene a special session so we can repeal and replace. And it will be such an honor for me, for you, and for everybody in this country, because Obamacare has to be replaced.
That was the first time yesterday that he's talked about this idea of convening a special session of Congress. Early voting here in Florida, we mentioned nearly about 4,100,000 people have voted. So far, Republicans lead in returns by about 15,000. Not to say that people voted along party lines, but that'll give you an indication of how the returns have been coming here. Brian, Steve,
right.
Ainsley.
All right, John, thank you very much.
And the interesting thing is also, go ahead, Steve.
I was going to say the interesting thing about that is usually Democrats lead in early voting. Mm-hmm. Republicans go to the polls the day of the vote.
And the real story also is, no one's talking about, is the black vote is really down everywhere, especially in North Carolina. It's down in Florida. Mm-hmm. It is down in some key states that could really
nothing
burn
compared
Hillary
to
Clinton.
What happened when President Obama was running.
In fact, that's what we're comparing it to.
Right.
And that's what Hillary Clinton was counting.
Right.
On.
You know, we like to tell you news that you're interested in, obviously. If you go to Google and you see what you guys are searching for, so many of you are searching for change early vote. Look at the spike in that at the end of October a few days ago. That was after the FBI reopened the investigation on Clinton, because many people out there in certain states were voting for Hillary Clinton, and they're interested now in changing their votes.
We should also point out that Donald Trump did mention yesterday out on the stump, as we just heard from John Roberts, that, you know, there are certain states. And what are they, Ainsley?
The states where you can do it. Wisconsin, Minnesota, Michigan, Pennsylvania, New York, Connecticut, and Mississippi.
You had a segment on that yesterday morning. Last night, Donald Trump's talking about it. Now people are looking to see if they can change their votes.
That's right. We did the segment because people were interested in it.
We did. Meanwhile, down in Sanford, Florida yesterday, Hillary Clinton was down there. And you know what? I don't think she likes Donald Trump, and she knows that there are a lot of people in Florida who are going to vote for him, even though she needs their vote, and she made this suggestion yesterday.
If you know anybody who's thinking about voting for Trump, well, first of all, stage an intervention. I mean, this... And... You know, if they've ever paid a dollar in income tax, ask them whether they think it's so smart for somebody to lose other people's money, claim a loss, and then not pay income taxes.
Right, and she continues to pretend as if people in big business don't do everything they can to pay as little taxes as possible. I think it's an insult to most of the audience.
Also, she's talking about something that's legal.
Yeah, she says that, and meanwhile, health care costs are skyrocketing and no one can afford it.
That's my exact point, is that Donald Trump was actually getting cheers because he was talking about policy yesterday, including Obamacare when signups began, because it was very apropos to what's happening. Hillary Clinton, to a degree, I think that she's getting a little desperate. When you wheel out Alicia Machado, who can barely speak English in Florida, to plead your case not to vote for the other guy, instead of saying, this is what I will do as president after the fireworks show when I celebrate, this is what I'm going to do. Instead, she's like, oh, you're not going to believe how bad the other guy is. While President Obama's out there saying, oh, by the way, if you don't vote for her, you just don't like women. You're sexist.
Well, listen, the race has tightened ever since the Comey surprise, and you know they're pulling out what they got.
Pulling out all the stops.
Yeah, look for them to throw
the right stop to close out an argument.
Was she convicted?
Maybe that's all they got.
Is she a criminal? She was convicted, or was she accused of crimes?
She had some rough years.
Yeah.
Okay, let's just go with that.
You're talking about the drug?
Yeah.
She was friends with a drug kingpin, it is alleged.
Yeah. Okay. We all have one friend that becomes a drug kingpin.
Meanwhile, who exactly was Donna Brazile's friend who fed her the question that she then fed to Hillary Clinton? We know that she did it at least twice, thanks to WikiLeaks.
It's about the primary debate?
Something like that. So anyway, the Daily Caller tried to figure out, okay, who could possibly, which of the women asked the question, and who did they tell that question to beforehand? Well, CNN has been floating this idea that maybe Donna Brazile heard the question from the woman who asked it, and they queried two different women.
Mickey Ward and Leanne Walters.
The day before at a charity event. And as it turns out, both women say, we never met her. We talked instead to a producer from Anderson Cooper, and we gave that person the questions.
Danelle Garcia is the producer at CNN that they said they talked to. Mickey Ward, like you were saying, and Leanne Walters, the two women who stood up and asked Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders debate questions in March.
Jeff Zucker says he's horrified. Jake Tapper says it's terrible. You know, everyone's upset that he actually got this, that these questions got out. And you just wonder, were these the only two questions, and is Donna Brazile the only one leaking things to Hillary Clinton? What other events took place? What other questions got out? Remember, Donna Brazile ended that email with more to come.
Well, CNN was confident that she did not receive the questions from anybody at CNN, and yet you put the dots together, and it doesn't look as if she got the questions directly from the women. Keep in mind as well, one of the things, thanks to WikiLeaks, is we see the collusion with the media this time that we have never seen before. The New York Times, you've got NBC, you've got MSNBC, you've got CNN, you've got all sorts of media outlets all in bed with the Clinton camp.
How about this? One of those WikiLeaks actually talked about the outrage they felt on an SNL skit that depicted George Soros and another one of their big donors on it. I don't even remember the skit. Next thing you know, the SNL takes down all links to that skit.
Really?
Wait a second. So they're even rigging the comedy shows?
Yeah.
You know,
because I have a few skits I'd like them to take down that might be retrievable.
With journalists that are with the mainstream media that are colluding in all of this, they need to learn a lesson from this, that you are going to get caught. And this is a prime example.
Yeah.
This journalist's name is all over the internet now.
So anyway, thought we'd bring you up to date on that. Meanwhile, look at this.
All right, 6 days from now, 6 days. Steve, you brought up a good point. Next week at this time, we're going to know who has won this election.
That's right.
We're going to have coverage for you all next week. Fox and Friends, we're going to be live starting at 5 a.m. And we're going to be, someone here at Fox will be live on the air at all times as the polls are opening and the votes come in. So stay with Fox News, America's election headquarters.
I don't mean to counter, Steve, but I remember Bush Gore.
I know, I thought about that when I said it.
We did not know who the president was.
I thought about that.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy. We're hoping that a week from right now, when you tune in, you'll know. Meanwhile, straight ahead on this Wednesday, Donna Brazile feeding debate questions to the Clinton camp is just the tip of the iceberg. We're breaking down the worst examples of media bias, and there are plenty coming up next.
And Starbucks trying to break the to bring the country back together with a special unity cup of coffee, but is doing just the opposite online. The revolt going viral straight ahead.
It's a rigged system, folks, and a big part of the rigging is the media. I will tell you right now, it's a big part of the rigging.
Donald Trump has called it out, his entire campaign, but media bias is reaching a fever pitch because we are just 6 days out from the big election day. Here to break down the most outrageous violations yet, Kelly Riddell. She is the deputy opinion editor at the Washington Times. Great to see you again, Kelly. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
Let's start with some examples of how the mainstream media is spinning this. Hillary Clinton's emails, and now they are blaming this on James Comey. It's an indictment on the FBI. Look at this. Mainstream media had 88 negative statements about Comey compared to 31 critical statements of Hillary Clinton in regards to this latest case. And then USA Today, their headline was, "Email case puts heat on FBI chief." What's your reaction?
I mean, this is just typical. This is what the Hillary Clinton campaign wanted to do as soon as this news broke, was basically turn this into an indictment on James Comey and not on her, and to deflect the attention. And this is what the mainstream media is doing. They also, the Clinton team, also dumped a bunch of oppo research on Donald Trump over the weekend and on Monday about his presumed his ties to Russia and how the FBI is looking into this. You see Harry Reid go on the Senate floor on Monday saying the FBI has explosive information about Trump's ties to Russia. And none of this has really panned out, but that did not stop NBC and CNBC from basically putting out very thinly reported stories about the FBI probing into Paul Manafort's ties with Russia, and then Slate putting out what is now a debunked story saying that Donald Trump had a private email server that connected directly to a bank in the Kremlin. Hillary Clinton tweeted that out, that story out, and it's been largely discredited because it just didn't make any sense by cybersecurity analysts. It's just not true.
We showed some of those headlines. The one that got me, Slate said, was a Trump server communicating with Russia. I was watching some of the mainstream media this morning while I was getting ready at home, and they were showing video of what people in Russia were doing and what they thought about the election. And I thought, do Americans, is that really care? Pertinent here? Do we care?
Yeah, no, I mean, but that is, that's one of
the... It does mean that I'm watching out for the people of South Carolina, and I'm watching out for the people of this country, and that's who I will be voting for on November 8th.
Wow, our next guest says this is the lesson to every working American, building off what the governor just said. Here to explain is CrowdPAC CEO and former advisor to UK Prime Minister David Cameron, Steve Hilton. Steve, you wrote a column about this, building off the Nikki Haley quote. Why?
Because I think that it goes to the heart of the choice that people have to make in the election, which is, what are going to be the real world consequences of the outcome for real people? If you look at what the Clinton campaign are doing, basically the whole campaign along, they've just been saying, don't vote for Trump because of his personal behavior. You saw even yesterday where she wheels out Miss Universe. There's no argument.
From Venezuela.
That's right. There's no argument about his policies, about his tax plan, his support for school choice, any of that stuff. It's just his personal behavior means he can't be president. Now, if you're rich, you can afford to take that view, because to be honest, if you have a President Clinton and the Democrats and more of the same economic stagnation, it doesn't really affect you. Your life is going to be fine. But if you're a working American who's really struggling to pay the bills, you don't find the job opportunities there, you're worried about the future for your kids, you can't afford to have 4 more years of the same economic stagnation. And that's why you've got to put the real impact before personal behavior and really look at policy.
You're the professional politico, but if I'm a candidate and I hired you to finish off my campaign, and my best closing argument is how bad the other guy is, I think I'm a failed candidate. It's all they're talking about is how thin-skinned, he doesn't pay taxes, and look at how he views women.
It's really embarrassing if you think about the fact that this is a person, Hillary Clinton, who's basically been plotting and scheming for this for 30 years. And right a few days before her big moment, she hasn't got a single inspiring message about the change that she will bring to real people's lives. She's just slagging off the other guy. It's really kind of embarrassing. And I think when people think about, well, when I come and vote and I really have to think about the impact of my vote on real life, that is the key, crucial factor.
So many people looked at Donald Trump and say, just prove yourself electable. And he kept tripping himself up. For the last 2.5 weeks, all he does is talk about policy. He was getting cheers on policy yesterday and barely brought up emails. fascinating as we look to see the close of this campaign, where most national polls have it within 2 points.
It's exactly right, because all along, right from the beginning, when Trump has been talking about the issues and about real change in real people's lives, he does well. And so when you have, like we saw a headline in the New York Times not long ago, which is, how could anyone vote for Trump?
Yeah, you write that in your column, how could anyone vote for Trump? And you come back as, is that really your best argument for voting for Clinton?
That's right, how could anyone vote for Trump? Because they don't want to, they literally can't understand how anyone could support a candidate with those personal characteristics. But that's because they don't want to engage in the real argument about what difference is going to be the result of voting for Trump versus Clinton on the economy, on schools, on healthcare, where he's got the message of change. And all she's saying is basically you're going to end up with more of the same, which has left the rich richer, but half of America earning less today than about 15 years ago.
Who would think a month ago we'd be talking 6 days out, we still don't know who's going to win? But that is exactly the case. Steve Hill,
good
great
to see you.
All right, good job. All right, coming up straight ahead, and we have a Fox News alert, and it's not good news. Breaking right now, two cops ambushed, shot dead in their patrol cars, two separate attacks. Brand new details just coming in from an emotional press conference with the chief of police. And World Series ratings are surging for the first time in a long time. Protests and a great matchup in baseball. What does the host of Fox NFL Sunday, Mr. Everything, Kurt Menefee, think? We're going to find out. We put a mic on him. I hope he talks.
This is a Fox News alert. It has happened once again. Two officers ambushed overnight, shot to death, sitting in their squad cars in Iowa.
That's right. Moments ago, a press conference where we learned the shooter apparently still on the loose. Heather Nauert joins us right now with breaking developments out of West Des Moines.
That's right. And it's a terrifying situation for folks who live there and the families of those officers. By the way, we don't know their identities just yet. But we are getting new details about the two police officers who were killed overnight in Iowa. They were murdered while sitting in their squad cars. The suspect still on the run, free to kill again. This happened just outside of Des Moines near a high school. In two separate locations, the shootings occurred 20 minutes apart. Fellow officers visibly shaken.
In all appearances, it looks just like that these officers were ambushed. It doesn't look like there was any interaction between these officers and whoever the coward is that shot them while they sat in their cars. That's the best we got that we can explain the scene right now. Both of them were in their cars.
Wow, this happened at 1:06 a.m. Central Time. Multiple law enforcement agencies are now involved in a massive manhunt at this hour. It is a breaking story. We're just getting in information, and we will bring you all the latest as the details continue to unfold. Customers bracing for gas prices to spike after a deadly pipeline explosion we first told you about yesterday. Alabama now under a state of emergency as crews repair the Colonial Pipeline. One worker was killed and five others were injured when an excavator hit the pipe.
Plume of fire. What appears to be a gas line explosion. Scene is still having explosions at this time. Cannot access the scene location.
Well, that pipeline supplies gasoline for millions of people on the East Coast. A separate leak back in September created massive shortages and price spikes throughout the Southeast. A disturbing warning for all parents. Please check your children's Halloween candy. This comes after police found needles and nails inside candy from trick-or-treating. You can see a nail right there sticking out of a Snickers bar. A parent in Michigan says her daughter bit into a thumbtack while eating a piece of candy. That is just terrible. And then in New Jersey, another family finding a sewing needle inside a Tootsie Roll and a small pin inside a Kit Kat. You can't be too safe. Please check it out. Well, the U2 frontman Bono is adding another award to his trophy case, but it is not what you would expect. Glamour magazine's first ever Man of the Year. Bono honored for his decades of humanitarian work helping the world's poorest women. Well, this year's other honorees include the singer Gwen Stefani, Olympian Simone Biles, and the founders of Black Lives Matter. And those are your headlines. I'll see you back here in just a little bit.
All right.
Thanks.
And Brian would concur. Brian loves
Bono.
Right. He does not return my calls, which I find strange. I do really do. I'm going to have to talk to the Edge from now on. Hey, are you ready? Are you ready for some football? A lot of fans are saying we are not ready this year. And it turns out baseball ratings are soaring. Heading into the World Series Game 7 tonight, NFL ratings are down, and the baseball ratings are up close to 40%. For football, many are blaming Colin Kaepernick when it began to start taking a knee during the national anthem.
Well, here to react to that is Fox NFL Sunday host and author of that new book right there. It's called Losing Isn't Everything, Kurt Menefee. Kurt, good to see you. Thanks for being here on the Curvy Couch. Do you think it is Colin Kaepernick's fault that ratings are down when it comes to football?
No, you know, if you look at it, I know that that's kind of the narrative that's gone out there, but the numbers don't bear it out. You know, if you want to look at it and look from a factual standpoint, I double-checked last night with our Fox researcher just to make sure I had my numbers correct. And when you take a look at it, people say they're boycotting games, and that's what the surveys say. But the same number of people are watching games that have been watching for the years. They just aren't watching as many minutes, as many out-of-town games. You look at CBS and Fox, which have the hometown teams and show the most games. Fox, at least before last Sunday, was down 1%. CBS is down single digits as well. Where the numbers are bad are those national games. Monday Night Football, Thursday Night Football, Sunday Night Football. Those games have been crap. I think that's part of it. But I do think the election is a large part of it as well. Because if you go back and you look at the years of 2000 when the Gore-Bush race was close, 2012 and this year are the only 3 years this entire century that the numbers have been down. If it's not up after the election, then I think you've got to look at other issues.
You're saying people are actually tuned into the news channel watching the news, so you're a little angry at us that we're taking your audience.
No, because it's Fox, we're doing fine.
That's right.
For football, people are still watching their hometown teams.
Right.
They're still, if you're a Giants fan and the Giants are playing the Eagles, you're watching the Eagles.
Plus,
I mean, the Giants Eagles. But you're not watching the out-of-town game. That's what happened.
Yeah, we won't be watching the Eagles. We'll be watching the Giants.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Kurt, there are also so many football games on television
I think it's a major problem.
Waters it down.
You know, here's another thing, too, and I think the NFL really has to address, and Mark Cuban hit on it a couple of years ago when he, you know, put out the famous line, you know, what, pigs get fat, hogs get slaughtered. Yep. The NFL, I think the product, and I shouldn't say this being a broadcaster of an NFL, from an NFL network, but there's so many games on that when there is a bad game on Monday night or Thursday night, you're like, I got more days of watching. I'm not going to watch this right now and stay here. I got to dedicate time to my family. And then you throw in high school football on Friday nights and college football on Saturday. You can oversaturate it.
And you guys got the Super Bowl this year.
Yes,
you're
sir.
The host of Fox NFL Sunday, and Terry Bradshaw considers himself the big personality. We like you better, a lot better. Congratulations on doing this book.
Losing isn't everything.
Kurt, you're focusing on people who've had their heart broken in sports, sometimes. A lot of times famously. Mm-hmm. Perhaps people remember this pitch to Hank Aaron breaking Babe Ruth's record. Let's listen. He's the guy who tossed the pitch.
Yeah, because that's kind of the focus of the book. I want to go back to people who have been part of major losses or crushing losses and find out how they dealt with it, because I think there's a lesson in it for all of us and how we overcome bad moments in our life, because we all have it.
Everybody.
It's at work, whether it's with the kids, whatever it is. And Al Downing was an interesting guy, because I grew up an Atlanta Braves fan. And one of my first sports memories was Hank Aaron hitting that home run. I was 8 years old. But Downing was a guy who, he was able to handle it fine. He was older when he pitched. He was in his 30s when that happened. His mother had died when he was 7 years old. And that was one of the things he said to me. He goes, look, my mom died when I was 7 years old. He came up in the 1960s, 1960 and 61, pitching in Richmond in the South as a black man and heard a lot of bad things. He goes, so for me to give up a home run towards the end of my career was not the worst thing that ever happened to me. So I was able to deal with it much better than other people were. People around him were the ones that had issues with it. And I think that's one of the interesting things about the book as well, is you find out these moments didn't just affect those that are involved in it. It affected their families and their friends, because we're all protective of people that we love when they get hurt.
David Tyree catches a ball on his head.
Yeah.
Who gave up that catch that enables the Giants to win the Super Bowl and the Patriots to lose?
Well, and remember, the Patriots were going for a perfect season. They were going to be 19-0 if they won that game, and they had the lead with less than a minute left. And David Tyree makes that catch. Rodney Harrison was there trying to defend it. And Harrison talked about the fact that he's in every picture right here that you see of it. That it affected him and his family until his wife and his mom snapped him out. But his thing was that Junior Seau was a member of that team. And Seau was at the end of his career, 19 years in the NFL. And when Harrison came in as a rookie with San Diego, Seau had taken him under his wing. And so he wanted to win a Super Bowl for Junior. Junior didn't win one that year, wound up retiring later on, committed suicide. They believe he had CTE, and that affected him more than anything else because that was his friend. And again, it's all about the emotion.
In perspective.
Yeah, exactly.
The story is behind the losses. Yeah. Losing Isn't Everything is the name of the book.
Thank you, Steve.
Kurt right. Benner.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. Send
this book to one of the losers next Tuesday.
Their whole staff may need a few of them. All right,
thank you. Congratulations on the book.
Thank you.
All right, straight ahead, President Obama pumping up the economy while stumping for Hillary Clinton.
We turned job losses into 15 million new jobs. And last year, incomes went up faster than any time that they've been keeping records.
Well, that sounds great, but our next guest is breaking down the numbers, and a Hillary Clinton presidency does not look good for the average American's wallet.
And what happens when Donald Trump makes a campaign stop at a local Wawa? The reaction is trending this morning. Say it with me. It's fun to say.
Wawa.
Hey, buddy. Hey,
enough here.
6 days to go. President Obama has been out on the campaign trail trying to get people excited to vote for Hillary Clinton and hyping the economy that he has overseen for the last 8 years.
We turned job losses into 15 million new jobs. Poverty went down faster than any time since 1968. We've seen an America that went from too many people uninsured to now 20 million people with health care who didn't have it before.
Okay, well, he's making things sound pretty good, right? Is it really as rosy as the president is painting it? And what's it going to mean for your wallet if she wins? Brian Brenberg is the chairman of business and finance at the King's College here in New York City. Well, Brian, you just heard the president. That sounds great. Is it accurate?
He's telling one part of the story, but he's conveniently leaving out a few things. He's leaving out the growth in debt. He's leaving out the number of long-term unemployed, people stuck in part-time jobs. He's leaving out the number of people who've dropped out of the labor force. He's leaving out food stamp enrollment. There's another side of the story that he's not telling here.
But he did mention health care. But health care, I don't know if I would be touting that.
I wouldn't be talking about that right now. The premium increases, the deductible increases, insurers dropping out of the market. That's the bad news story that's been added to the last 7 years of a difficult economy that's really got people thinking about, what do I want to see over the next 4 years?
Yeah. When you look at, I heard Mrs. Clinton say yesterday, my plans don't add a penny to the deficit. Here's some of the stuff on her wish list right now. $350 billion for tuition-free college. Sounds great. $275 billion for infrastructure, sounds great. $300 billion for family leave, $60 billion for clean energy, although we've spent plenty on that and that hasn't worked out so well. What do you think about that?
Well, she says she's going to raise taxes by about $1.5 trillion on the wealthy to pay for that. But you know what? That doesn't even handle the deficits that she's already going to inherit. The debt's going to increase by over $9 trillion on her watch. So it's not good enough just to pay for your new spending. You have to pay for the fact that we have all this built-in spending from things like Obamacare that are going to send the debt way up over the next 10 years.
And ultimately, don't you think she's going to have to wind up raising taxes, and it's going to wind up
You can't balance that budget on the backs of the rich. They're simply not going to pay for it. They're going to find other ways to invest their money. So I think the likelihood is the middle class is going to pay for this one way or the other.
Sure. And we heard earlier in the program, we ran a soundbite where she said, if you know somebody who's going to vote for Donald Trump, you need to stage an intervention. And then she went through the litany of how he used the tax rules to his advantage. Those are the rules.
Yeah, you know, when you're going to go after somebody for playing by the rules, I don't think you've got a winning argument there. They should be talking about the policy issues. Who's going to grow this economy over the next 4 years? I don't think more government spending, I don't think higher taxes is a route to do that.
All right. Professor, thank you very much for joining
Always
us.
Always good to see you.
All right. Thank you, sir. All right. Coming up, stunning new developments. After email show 10 hack attacks on Hillary Clinton's illegal server in just 2 days. 10 in 2. Lieutenant General Michael Flynn is furious. He joins us in 10 minutes. Then Governor Scott Walker facing a firestorm of controversy for this tweet. Carly Shimkus here with why people think Walker just endorsed Hillary. But did he?
I love that guy that flips.
The internet goes wild when a tweet from one of Hillary Clinton's strongest critics is interpreted as an endorsement for Hillary Clinton.
Yep, here with a breakdown of what's trending this morning. Fox News headlines 24/7, key reporter. Ooh. XM 115 is where you find her.
But
right
like
now, she's with us. Carly
like
Shimkus, welcome back.
Carly.
We got to find out what's happening in Wisconsin. What's going on?
Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker's anti-Clinton tweet backfired in a big way. So he tried to make a case for voters to vote for Donald Trump. He
He tweeted, if you like the past 8 years, vote Hillary Clinton. Well, the problem is a lot of people thought he was endorsing Clinton in that tweet. Chris Jackson writes, this is going to be your most popular tweet, but not in the way you hoped. Evan says, I didn't know who Scott Walker was, and as soon as I saw that tweet, I thought he was an HRC supporter. And Kevin tweets, I'm Scott Walker, and I'm confused by this message.
It is
not a good one.
It is a little confusing. Maybe there are people out there who liked the last 8 years, and so they would think that's
and
exactly
a lot of people, a lot of Democrats responded to that tweet and said, thank you for the tip. So right. I don't think that's what he was
and
looking for.
And apparently we are not the only ones that like the Wawa.
Wawa.
The food at Wawa. Donald Trump.
The coffee.
His daughter, Tiffany.
Yeah, picture this. You're standing in a Wawa doing some of your normal shopping, crossing off the shopping list, when in walks in Donald Trump, his daughter, Tiffany, and legendary Indiana basketball coach, Bobby Knight.
Amazing.
Apparently, he didn't buy anything, but he stopped to take some pictures. Those pictures are going viral online. Other members of his entourage, though, reportedly picked up some tasty cakes.
Wait a minute. You're saying they went in, they didn't buy anything. They just went window shopping at Wawa?
Donald Trump didn't buy anything. Oh. Personally, you know you always look for what the candidate's going to buy.
All right.
And you, go ahead.
I was going to say from Wawa back to Wisconsin.
Wawa to Wisconsin.
Tim Kaine, with one comment, could have lost the election in that state for his woman.
He made a crucial error. He asked a reporter, what's a cheese curd?
Oh.
That's like asking a reporter in Pennsylvania, what's a cheese steak?
Right.
You gotta know your food on the campaign trail. So Tim Kaine responded to the reporter who tweeted about it saying, we didn't have cheese curds growing up in Kansas City, but man, have I been missing out.
Oh, trying to redeem himself.
Now this story does have a happy ending though, because he was spotted at a restaurant later that day eating cheese curds.
Of course he
with
was.
With radish, with a horseradish.
Well,
which I've never had a cheese
was.
Curd with a horseradish before.
You can get it at Wawa.
I guess so.
Well, so what's the theory then? The theory is know what's indigenous to the people of that state.
Remember when?
Be smart.
Yes.
Sure. Remember when John Kerry was down in Philly and he went to either Geno's or Pat's and he ordered a cheesesteak and he asked for
a
Swiss cheese.
Oh,
on it.
And he called it a sub, I think, not a hoagie.
Oh, he did.
Oh, man, it was just
there should be a
catastrophe.
There should be somebody in your campaign completely dedicated to teaching you the food of that area because it always becomes a big viral topic if you get it wrong.
All right. When in New York. Do not eat the pizza with
a fork.
Exactly right.
Exactly.
All right. Carly, thank you very much.
And know what pizza is
if
coming to New York.
Exactly, and how to pronounce it. Hey, guess who's coming up next? You see them all the time introducing Donald Trump at his live events. Now he's going to be with us in studio. How do I know? I recognize the hall. He is Lieutenant General Michael Flynn, and he is here live.
While they were just sitting in their patrol cars in two different locations. A manhunt is now underway for a killer. The breaking details in just moments.
Meanwhile, 6 days until the election, and the ghosts of Bill Clinton's past just came back to haunt him and haunt Hillary as well in a brand new October surprise. This one on the first day of November. Not from WikiLeaks, but this one from the FBI.
Plus, Donald Trump has a new message for America. It is not too late to change your mind and your vote.
This is a good time to make an important public service announcement. You can change your vote to Donald Trump. We'll make America great again, okay?
All right, we're live in, on the campaign trail to talk more about that because your mornings are better because you chose to watch with friends.
Fox News alert this morning, a cold-blooded cop killer on the run at this hour after shooting two police officers in Iowa, sparking fears that more officers will be murdered. Both officers were just sitting helplessly in their patrol cars in two separate locations.
Yep, the shootings just happened 20 minutes apart near a high school just outside Des Moines. One of the patrol cars was riddled with bullets.
I actually used to live three blocks away from where one of those police officers were shot. Now, their fellow officers, while visibly shaken, vowing to find the dangerous killer who is still, at this hour, on the run.
In all appearances, it looks just like that these officers were ambushed. On the surface right now, just like I said, we're just a few hours into this, it doesn't look like there was any interaction between these officers and whoever the coward is that shot them while they sat in their cars. That's the best we got that we can explain the scene right now. There's definitely some danger out there. There's somebody out there shooting police officers. We hope we find him before anybody else gets hurt.
All the schools in that area, they're shut down today. Breaking details are coming in by the minute, so stay with us for the latest on this horrific story.
Let's bring in Lieutenant General Michael Flynn. You know, he's a big supporter of Donald Trump, been on the trail with him a lot. The one thing, General, that we always notice about Donald Trump, especially over the last 2 weeks, he reacts to the news.
Yeah.
And the news now is law and order.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this is unbelievable tragedy. So you got these, you know, two great police officers that, as the, I guess the chief that just said, they were, looks like they were targeted, they were ambushed. I mean, the assault on our law enforcement professionals in this country is out of control. And I would love to see the leadership in our country today come out and say, look, this has got to end. Whoever did this particular shooting of these two great police officers, and I'll tell you, as we have gone around the country and in the, you know, in this experience that I'm, you know, having with Donald Trump, the law enforcement community is you know, reaching out in such a big way to him because of the, you know, the compassion and frankly the support that he has shown to them to be able to say the kinds of things that we need to say. So this is just another tragedy, another example of the lack of safety that we have in our streets and our country for these police officers. My God.
You know, how did the anti-cop narrative get so loud?
Yeah, you know, I mean, it gets loud when leadership doesn't step in, okay? The anti-police narrative, the anti-law enforcement narrative, the anti-rule of law narrative gets louder when leadership does not step in. And the leadership at the local level, particularly by our chiefs of police, has been superb. It's the leadership from the White House. And you have to step in immediately when you see this
assault. Is it a political thing?
I don't know if it's a political thing, but what I know is that when we have police officers being ambushed and killed in the streets of our cities and our, you know, in this country, it has got to stop.
Yeah, we need to say a prayer for each of those families.
We do.
And the cops that work in that area, because this gunman's still on the loose.
Right, right.
By the way, sorry. I would love for the, just building what you said, I'd love for the president to say something.
Yeah, I would too. I mean, come on.
I would love for him to say that, listen, it doesn't matter what color you are. An attack on law and order is an attack on our society.
Right.
But let's just pivot to something about this election. With 6 days left, a couple of things happen. The FBI comes out and makes the announcement about the discovery of 650,000 emails. And then yesterday, responding to a Freedom of Information Act, they went back to 2001 and put forward documents about the Marc Rich pardon that Bill Clinton okayed. How important is that?
This just shows the continuation of the incredible dark cloud of scandals that sits over the Clinton machine. I mean, I describe this as the largest organized crime investigation probably in decades that the FBI is having to go through. You're talking about, you know, the Anthony Weiner pedophilia scandal. You're talking about the reopening of a national security investigation against Hillary Clinton, who is, you know, 4 or 5 days now away from potentially being a president. Give me a break. I mean, when is enough going to be enough for these people? In addition to the WikiLeaks, in addition to more stuff that's going to come out. I understand that, you know, there's talk about the quote-unquote 33,000 emails coming out today or tomorrow. Mm-hmm. I mean, the 33,000 are probably in the 650,000. This is unprecedented. It's unbelievable.
You mentioned the emails, and we were just learning this morning. Judicial Watch recently discovered that Hillary Clinton's server was the target of 10 hack attempts in a 2-day period. This was back in 2010, and the hackers were trying to log on as different people within her campaign, like Doug Bann and Abbott. What's your reaction?
Right. Well, you know, all this stuff, and then the things that we are seeing in the email discussions that are coming out. I mean, even those, they're it's disgusting. This is a disgusting way to run. I mean, I would never allow this in any military organization at all. Any type of the kind of conversations that are being had in these emails are just, it's unbelievable. I would tell you that the whole effort that's going on with, when they talk about the cyber attacks and the hacking, I mean, this has been going on for many, many years. So for any of these people to be talking about what has happened or wouldn't happen, I mean, to me, this is just unbelievable. So I mean, what we're facing is an incredible level of scandal, criminal behavior. I mean, there's serious criminal behavior that is directly related to Hillary Clinton's
actions.
And
that foundation?
In the foundation, I mean, everything.
You know what?
It's funny, but it's all coming together. This 650,000, It's like Anthony Weiner is going to end up, you know, tying all this together because he probably was using this as a get out of jail free card.
Well, apparently he is cooperating. We don't know exactly what the cooperation means. Yeah. But there's a story out this morning that, you know, given the fact that he was sexting, he's in big trouble for sexting with at least one underage teenager. Now there's a report that he could have been the perfect target for hacking into her server because his then wife was one of the users.
Yeah, I mean, there's two other things here that I think, in my experience with investigations, which we've had quite a bit actually in the area of espionage and also just the extortion side. So you have elements here that are so dangerous for our national security because you likely have classified information, highly classified information in this 650,000. So if Anthony Weiner had access to them, that means there are many, many other people that had access to them.
Just the President of the United States evidently had
that's the extortion.
The blackmail.
The President of the United States evidently had an alias too, and he was going back and forth with Hillary Clinton on a private server. But, General, are you when you talk about espionage and stuff that you've been involved in, it does bother me that we're doing this off Julian Assange's hack because this guy's an international criminal.
Yeah.
Does it bother you?
Yeah, it bothers me. But it also what bothers me more. It's not about Julian Assange. It's not about Russia. It's not about Anthony Weiner. It's about Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton is the one that made the decision to have an unclassified server in some closet somewhere to do government very, very sensitive government business for 4 years.
And that's why Barack Obama should be the angriest. Hired you to do a job, and you did all this. Now, here's the other thing.
He should be, but in a way, Brian, he's caught. He's caught because the leaks of information that are coming out are going to show, unless they pull them for national security reasons, they're going to show that our president was in communication with Hillary Clinton. And in fact, he said he wasn't. He said he found out about it through the media. So
sure. And with the WikiLeaks stuff, this is where we are in society with technology now. Yeah. This is like the whistleblower of 2016.
Yeah. That's right.
General, the other thing is, that what so makes this so unique, I was thinking about it this morning, is that if you didn't like Al Gore, you didn't vote for Al Gore. You don't like Bush, you don't like Bush. You didn't like Barack Obama, you didn't vote for Barack Obama. You wanted to find out more information, but it was just, let's just find out more information to find out what kind of agenda it'll have.
Right.
This is different.
This is
what are you hiding? How deep does this go? Yeah. How else are you involved? What do you really mean? How are you rigging the primaries in order to get the nomination? The more you look, the uglier it gets. Like it or not, Donald Trump is so transparent. He got himself in a lot of trouble between his tweets and what he says and answering questions maybe too candidly.
Yeah,
a little too honest, you mean?
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, journalism is under attack this election for sure because there's been so much. Frankly, there's just been deceit in your business. And I'm being very frank. This has become a social media election. And I'm telling you, you look at you guys pay attention to it. You report on it all the time. This is a digital election and it has changed. And all this leak stuff, if it's showing one thing is that you cannot hide anything.
Yeah.
And so it's like I've said it publicly. Hack my emails because I would love to have somebody put out what I say. Because what I'm saying right here is what I say in my emails. I don't disparage people like, you know, all the kinds of words that we're hearing said in the emails.
General, there's a brand new ABC Washington Post tracking poll that has just come out in the last 10 minutes or so, and apparently on the question of honesty and trustworthiness, now Donald Trump eclipses Hillary Clinton. He's in front of her at this point, according to what was just whispered in my ear. Yeah. I got to ask you something that Mr. Trump was talking about out on the trail yesterday.
Yeah.
He said, look, you know, some of you may have already early voted for Hillary Clinton. It's not too late to change your vote.
Right.
How many people, as you go out, have you met or heard say, you know, I wish I could have a do-over on that?
Yeah, well, the other day.
Is this a big number we're talking
about? I don't know if it's a big number, but I think that people ought to have a, I'm glad that those states have the opportunity to show up to the polls, because I guess if you show up to the polls on polling day, if you've previously voted, you can re-vote. You can recast your vote, and I guess there's five states. I think that that's a big deal. I don't know what the numbers are going to be, but I think it's going to be very interesting to see what those numbers are, to see how many people re-voted.
If you look at the trends on Google, it is
interesting because no one's really checking it until the latest investigation drops on the 31st.
All
then
sudden,
all of a sudden a spike goes up
with
people Googling, how do you change your vote?
Right. So I think you're going to see a number of people recast their vote, and I think you're going to see it.
You can't explain it. You lived it, and you're getting briefed along with Donald Trump in many cases. But it's hard to take your eye off what's happening in the world. ISIS calling for attacks on the West Coast. Mosul about to fall. We turning this over to Iran. The challenge is what's happening in Syria. Russia on the march. China beginning to expand. When Donald Trump looks at this, do you sense, does he know what he's getting into?
Yeah, he does. And it's, you know, this is an incredibly serious time for the United States of America. And it's a very, very important time for the U.S. to demonstrate leadership. We have such a deficit of leadership right here at home and around the world, and that has got to change. And Donald Trump, you know, that's his big message is make America great again, and his bigger message is we are going to start leading again.
Yeah, well, a week from today, next Wednesday morning, we'll know who the next president is.
That's great.
General, thank you very much.
Where are you heading now?
Back out the door.
You go back on the road with them?
Back on the road,
Meanwhile, I know we're going. We're going straight to Election Day. Remember, 6 days from now, Fox News has Election Day covered all day. Fox and Friends is going to start at 4 a.m., and Fox News will have continuous live coverage through the nights as the votes come in. We know you want to know how every state comes in, so stay here on Fox, your official American election headquarters.
Thanks so much, General. Meanwhile, coming up straight ahead, 6 days until Election Day, and Donald Trump has a new message for America. It is not too late to change your mind.
This is a good time to make an important public service announcement. You can change your vote to Donald Trump will make America great again, okay?
We are live on the campaign trail with Donald Trump. That'll be next.
Donald Trump is seizing momentum in the final 6 days of this election, now heading to the must-win state of Florida.
The Republican nominee telling early Clinton voters it's not too late to change their minds.
You know, John Roberts would probably like to change his mind over this assignment. He said, yeah, I'll follow Trump around. It's turned out to be a really crazy ride, and he joins us this morning from Miami.
You know what? It's not like getting on one of those roller coasters where you're at the top of the first hill, Steve, and say, oh, was this a good idea? We love it. This is the most incredible election that I've ever followed, and I've been doing every one since 1996. Good morning to you, Steve, Ainsley, Brian. Here we are in Miami this morning. It's the first of three stops in the Sunshine State that Donald Trump has got today. He's also here again tomorrow. 29 electoral votes. This is the big prize of all the battleground states. And it really could be said that if Donald Trump loses Florida, it's all over for him. But the polls are looking good. Real Clear Politics average of polls. He's up by a point. New York Times poll that was out a couple of days ago has got him up by four. And Republicans are actually leading in the amalgamation of the early vote returns between absentee balloting and in-person. He's got a big rally this morning at the Bayfront Amphitheater here along the shores of Biscayne Bay. Should be a good visual for him if he's trying to get enthusiasm pumped up in the Sunshine State. Yesterday, a big rally in Eau Claire, Wisconsin. Donald Trump suggested to folks out there, hey, if you've already cast your ballot in certain states and you want to change your mind, it's not too late. Here's what he said.
For any Democratic voter who have already cast their ballots for Hillary Clinton and who are having a bad case of buyer's remorse. Wisconsin is one of several states where you can change your early ballot if you think you've made a mistake.
There's actually seven states in total. Here they are: Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, Minnesota, Michigan, New York, Connecticut, and Mississippi. The deadline in Minnesota passed yesterday. You've got to have it in by close of business a week before the actual election. Today, Donald Trump will be going hard against the Clinton campaign on the FBI reopening its investigation. John Podesta talking about dumping these emails. But of course, as he did yesterday in Valley Forge, he'll be making Obamacare a big issue with so many folks across the country facing double-digit increases. Then he's absolutely astronomical deductibles that a lot of people are looking at, $12,000-$14,000 for some plans. You know, Mike Pence yesterday saying in Valley Forge, it's time for Republicans to come home around this issue. The subtle suggestion there that even if you're not fully on board with Donald Trump, be fully on board with this issue. It's one that Republicans can vote on. Ainsley, Brian, Steve.
All right.
Thanks, John.
Yeah,
I'm just imagining all these people who work for the Election Commission where folks are coming in saying, I want to change my ballot. And they're like, oh, let me go look under the K's for Kilmeade and find your ballot.
Oh, I threw that one out already.
Sure. Now, one state you can't change your mind is Ohio, where you wonder if John Kasich would like to change his vote. Yeah, because he did write in John McCain, which isn't going to count because John McCain is not one of the people who's actually
running. He's not running.
Did he use the same pen he used to sign the pledge to say he would vote for the nominee?
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. All right. Meanwhile, straight ahead, the president blowing off the latest Hillary Clinton investigation.
Has she made mistakes? Of course, so have I. There's nobody in the public arena over the course of 30 years that doesn't make some.
Are Democrats in denial? A debate next.
Before dinner.
Less than a week to go, 6 days until Election Day, and Democrats are still standing by Hillary Clinton despite her latest FBI woes.
Has she made mistakes? Of course, so have I. There's nobody in the public arena over the course of 30 years that doesn't make some. But she is a fundamentally good and decent person who knows what she's doing and will be an outstanding president.
So, are some Democrats just in denial for a fair and balanced debate? Let's bring in the vice chair of the National Diversity Council for Trump, Brunel Donald Shea, joins us from Chicago, and Fox News contributor Jamu Green, who was a 2008 Clinton campaign advisor. Good morning, ladies. Thank you both for joining us.
Good morning. God bless you, and God bless America.
Indeed. All right, Jamu, let's start with you. We just heard the president say Hillary Clinton has made mistakes in the past. You know, ever since the Comey surprise of last Friday, a lot of people are going, I don't know. And in fact, some of her support has weakened a bit. What do you think?
I think that there were 70,000 activists and volunteer shifts booked this weekend for the Hillary campaign. And for the last 4 days of the campaign, they have something like 750,000 shifts booked. It's interesting to ask if Democrats are in denial. Donald Trump's last salvo to the American people are, one, you can change your vote.
Which is true.
And two, he's having Mike Pence talk longer than him in Pennsylvania because they're still trying to corral Republican voters. This is a man who looks at preparing for anything, whether it's a debate or get out the vote. He looks at it with disdain. What do you do in a campaign? You raise the money, you build the ground game, and now he is trying to find voters, seek them out. The Hillary Clinton campaign, they are turning out their voters.
Okay.
They've contacted them, they know where they are, and they are focused on that. So there's no denial. It's just the execution and the final days, of a pretty well-run campaign.
Indeed. All right, Jamu, in a number of states, you can actually change your vote if you have buyer's remorse. Brunel, what do you think? Are some Democrats in denial over Hillary Clinton's problems?
I believe they are in denial. And you know, when you've got the top person, the president, who's supposed to be the example for the nation, telling us that this person is the most qualified with five FBI Bureau investigations, two open investigations, the Wiener pedophilia investigation, as well as the pay to play with the Clinton Foundation, as well as the emails reopened. When you've got our top person not saying step down, not, you know, leading and morality and ethics, why would you expect the rest of the party to fall in, you know, to do the right thing? But what I would say is this. The Democratic Party has sent out people to cause violence at rallies. That's been ratified. They have not given us any reason with this open borders through Hillary Clinton, with the Supreme Court picks that won't be conservative, with she's never created a private sector job in her life. Donald Trump has created over 60,000 private sector jobs.
Okay.
He's got so many reasons why he should be the next president, and we're not in denial. He's not under investigation.
Okay.
We're voting for the one that's not under investigation.
And Brunel would know something about Democratic politics. She's
not
been
FBI investigation.
She's been a lifelong Democrat. Jamu, I want to ask you about this new ABC Washington Post tracking poll that has just come out in the last half hour. And what it shows is that Donald Trump now is regarded by more Americans to be more honest and trustworthy. And you got to figure part of that is regarding the FBI stuff and everything we have learned from the WikiLeaks, which has been very embarrassing.
Look, Secretary Clinton is the first person to say that she...
This is Russell. Cubs at first to game seven.
long at Progressive Field last night, scoring three runs in the first inning, followed by a powerful grand slam in the fourth by Addison Russell. Both teams facing a combined 174-year championship drought. 174 years. Wow. That will come to an end for one of those teams tonight. They face off again in Cleveland at 8 o'clock Eastern time. Can't wait to watch that final game. And those are your headlines. We'll keep watching.
Yeah, I mean, they set all kinds of records in terms of ratings. It's beating football. And Kurt Benefee is going to be out here shortly to talk about what it's meant for Fox Sports.
This is the cover of the New York Post today. Weight of the world tonight. Right. One of the two teams will be
That's
the winner.
That's when it gets good. That's how you know you have really good teams that are in the World Series that are competing, when it gets down to one final game.
Yep.
My theory is, if you have a hex, if you're hexed, and the other team is also hexed, it neutralizes the pressure on the hex.
Sure.
Two hexes means no hex.
Well, but for...
I don't know what you're talking about, but okay.
You don't know what the heck I'm talking about?
No.
Meanwhile, from the World Series to the Super Bowl, which is next Tuesday, when it comes to politics, Donald Trump seizing momentum in the final 6 days of the election, now heading to the must-win state of Florida.
That's right. The Republican nominee urging early Clinton voters to recast their ballots in the wake of this latest FBI investigation.
All right. Fox News' senior national correspondent John Roberts is live in Miami with the very latest. Hey, John.
It was close.
I'm just going to give up, Brian. Yeah. Just say here's
We're almost
John.
Done. I got six more days to get it right.
Yeah, there you go. We'll keep trying. Good morning to you, Brian, Steve, Ainsley. It always feels good to be in Florida. Somehow waking up in Miami on the shores of Biscayne Bay is just a wonderful thing. Three numbers, to keep in mind here. 29, 4, and 4,093,000. 29 electoral votes up for grabs. This is the big prize of all of the swing states. Donald Trump leads in a new New York Times Siena poll by 4 points, and 4,093,000 people have already cast early ballots. Today, Donald Trump with a big rally here in downtown Miami at the amphitheater at Bayfront Park. That's going to provide him a very big visual in terms of creating enthusiasm to get people out to vote here in the Sunshine State. Yesterday, a big rally in Eau Claire, Wisconsin, where Donald Trump urged people who have voted for Hillary Clinton in four states where they allow it to change their vote on Election Day. Listen to what he said.
For any Democratic voter who have already cast their ballots for Hillary Clinton and who are having a bad case of buyer's remorse, Wisconsin is one of several states where you can change your early ballot if you think you've made a mistake.
Yeah. Those other states are Michigan, Pennsylvania, Minnesota, by the way. Donald Trump yesterday continued to highlight Hillary Clinton's lingering problems with the FBI investigation. He'll do that again today, but also going deep into policy yesterday with a speech in Valley Forge, Pennsylvania on Obamacare. Of course, he's promised to repeal and replace it, but upping the ante yesterday, saying that he would make this a big priority and would do that through Congress with a very interesting way to do it. Listen to what he said.
I will ask Congress to convene a special session so we can repeal and replace. And it will be such an honor for me, for you, and for everybody in this country, because Obamacare has to be replaced.
That was the first time yesterday that he's talked about this idea of convening a special session of Congress. Early voting here in Florida, we mentioned nearly about 4,100,000 people have voted. So far, Republicans lead in returns by about 15,000. Not to say that people voted along party lines, but that'll give you an indication of how the returns have been coming here. Brian, Steve,
right.
Ainsley.
All right, John, thank you very much.
The
interesting thing about that is usually Democrats lead in early voting. Mm-hmm. Republicans go to the polls the day of the voting.
And the real story also is, no one's talking about, is the black vote is really down everywhere, especially in North Carolina. It's down in Florida. Mm-hmm. It is down in some key states that could really
Nothing
burn
compared
Hillary
to
Clinton.
What happened when President Obama was running.
In fact, that's who we're comparing it to.
Right.
And that's what Hillary Clinton was counting
right.
on.
Right. You know, we like to tell you news that you're interested in, obviously. If you go to Google and you see what you guys are searching for, so many of you are searching for change early vote. Look at the spike in that at the end of October a few days ago. That was after the FBI reopened the investigation on Clinton, because many people out there in certain states were voting for Hillary Clinton, and they're interested now in changing their votes.
We should also point out that Donald Trump did mention yesterday out on the stump, as we just heard from John Roberts, that, you know, there are certain states states. And what are they, Ainsley?
The states where you can do it. Wisconsin, Minnesota, Michigan, Pennsylvania, New York, Connecticut, and Mississippi.
You had a segment on that yesterday morning. Last night, Donald Trump's talking about it. Now people are looking to see if they can change their votes.
That's right. We did the segment because people were interested in it.
We did. Meanwhile, down in Sanford, Florida yesterday, Hillary Clinton was down there. And you know what? I don't think she likes Donald Trump. And she knows that there are a lot of people in Florida who are going to vote for him, even though she needs their vote. And she made this suggestion yesterday.
If you know anybody who's thinking about voting for Trump, well, first of all, stage an intervention. I mean, this... And, you know, if they've ever paid a dollar in income tax, ask them whether they think it's so smart for somebody to lose other people's money, claim a loss, and then not pay income taxes.
Right, and she continues to pretend as if people in big business don't do everything they can to pay as little taxes as possible. I think that's an insult to most of the audience.
Also, she's talking about something that's legal.
Yeah, she says that, and meanwhile, health care costs are skyrocketing. Yeah. And no one can afford it.
Ainsley, that's my exact point, is that Donald Trump was actually getting cheers because he was talking about policy yesterday, including Obamacare, when signups began, because it was very apropos to what's happening. Hillary Clinton, to a degree, I think that she's getting a little desperate. When you wheel out Alicia Machado, who can barely speak English in Florida, to plead your case not to vote for the other guy, instead of saying, this is what I will do as president after the fireworks show when I celebrate, this is what I'm going to do. Instead, she's like, oh, you're not going to believe how bad the other guy is. While President Obama's out there saying, oh, by the way, if you don't vote for her, you just don't like women. You're sexist.
Well, listen, the race has tightened ever since the Comey surprise, and you know they're pulling out what they got.
Pulling out all the stops.
Yeah, look for them to throw
the... But is that the right stop to close out an argument?
Was she convicted?
Maybe that's all they got.
Was she a criminal? She was convicted, or was she accused of crimes?
She had some rough years.
Yeah.
Okay, let's just go.
You're talking about the drug.
Yeah.
She was friends with a drug kingpin, it is alleged.
Yeah. Okay. We all have one friend that becomes a drug kingpin.
Meanwhile, who exactly was Donna Brazile's friend who fed her the question that she then fed to Hillary Clinton? We know that she did it at least twice thanks to WikiLeaks.
Is that about the primary debate?
Something like that. So anyway, the Daily Caller tried to figure out, okay, who could possibly, which of the women asked the question, and who did they tell that question to beforehand? Well, CNN has been floating this idea that maybe Donna Brazile heard the question from the woman who asked it, and they queried two different women.
Ward and Leanne Walters.
The day before at a charity event. And as it turns out, both women say, we never met her. We talked instead to a producer from Anderson Cooper, and we gave that person the question.
Danelle Garcia is the producer at CNN that they said they talked to. Mickey Ward, like you were saying, and Leanne Walters, the two women who stood up and asked Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders debate questions in March.
Jeff Zucker says he's horrified. Jake Tapper says it's terrible. You know, everyone's upset that he actually got this, that these questions got out, and you just wonder, were these the only two questions, and is Donna Brazile the only one leaking things to Hillary Clinton? What other events took place? What other questions got out? Remember, Donna Brazile ended that email with more to come.
Well, CNN was confident that she did not receive the questions from anybody at CNN, and yet you put the dots together, and it doesn't look as if she got the questions directly from the women. Keep in mind as well, one of the things, thanks to WikiLeaks, is we see the collusion with the media this time that we have never seen before. The New York Times, you've got NBC, you've got MSNBC, you've got CNN, you've got all sorts of media outlets all in bed with the Clinton camp.
How about this? One of those WikiLeaks actually talked about the outrage they felt on an SNL skit that depicted George Soros and another one of their big donors on it. I don't even remember the skit. Next thing you know, the SNL takes down all links to that skit.
Really?
Wait a second. So they're even rigging the comedy shows?
Yeah.
You know,
because I have a few skits I'd like them to take down that might be retrievable.
Well, journalists that are with the mainstream media that are colluding in all of this, they need to learn a lesson from this, that you are going to get caught. And this is a prime example. This journalist's name is all over the internet now.
So anyway, Thought we'd bring you up to date on that. Meanwhile, look at this.
All right, 6 days from now, 6 days. Steve, you brought up a good point. Next week at this time, we're going to know who has won this election.
That's right.
We're going to have coverage for you all next week. Fox and Friends, we're going to be live starting at 5 a.m., and we're going to be someone here at Fox will be live on the air at all times as the polls are opening and the votes come in. So stay with Fox News, America's election headquarters.
I don't mean to counter, Steve, but I remember a Bush Gore.
I thought about that when I said who the president was. I thought about that.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy. We're hoping that a week from right now, when you tune in, you'll know. Meanwhile, straight ahead on this Wednesday, Donna Brazile feeding debate questions to the Clinton camp is just the tip of the iceberg. We're breaking down the worst examples of media bias, and there are plenty coming up next.
And Starbucks trying to break the bring the country back together with a special unity cup of coffee, but is doing just the opposite online. The revolt going viral straight ahead.
It's a rigged system, folks, and a big part of the rigging is the media. I will tell you right now, it's a big part of the rigging.
Donald Trump has called it out, his entire campaign, but media bias is reaching a fever pitch because we are just 6 days out from the big election day. Here to break down the most outrageous violations yet, Kelly Riddell. She is the deputy opinion editor at the Washington Times. Great to see you again, Kelly. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
Let's start with some examples of how the mainstream media is spinning this. Let's take, for instance, the investigation into Hillary Clinton's emails, and now they are blaming this on James Comey. It's an indictment on the FBI. Look at this. Mainstream media had 88 negative statements about Comey compared to 31 critical statements of Hillary Clinton in regards to this latest case. And then USA Today, their headline was, "Email case puts heat on FBI chief." What's your reaction?
I mean, this is just typical. This is what the Hillary Clinton campaign wanted to do as soon as this news broke, was basically turn this into an indictment on James Comey and not on her, and to deflect the attention. And this is what the mainstream media is doing. They also, the Clinton team, also dumped a bunch of Oppo research on Donald Trump over the weekend and on Monday about his presumed his ties to Russia and how the FBI is looking into this. You see Harry Reid go on the Senate floor on Monday saying the FBI has explosive information about Trump's ties to Russia. And none of this has really panned out, but that did not stop NBC and CNBC from basically putting out very thinly reported stories about the FBI probing into Paul Manafort's ties with Russia. And then Slate putting out what is now a debunked story saying that Donald Trump had a private email server that connected directly to a bank in the Kremlin. Hillary Clinton tweeted that out, that story out, and it's been largely discredited because it just didn't make any sense by cybersecurity analysts. It's just not true.
We showed some of those headlines. The one that got me, Slate said, was a Trump server communicating with Russia. I was watching some of the mainstream media this morning while I was getting ready at home, and they were showing video of what people in Russia were doing and what they thought about the election. And I thought, do Americans, is that really pertinent here? Do we care?
Yeah, no, I mean, but that's one of the lines that they want to carry forward. And the New York Times came out yesterday with a story. It was on page 19, by the way, that said that the FBI...
21, actually. 21, Kelly.
Yeah, 21. Yeah. It was on page 21 that the FBI looked into Donald Trump's ties with Russia, and they found nothing. But on the front page of the New York Times was a story about Donald Trump's dubious taxes, which it turned out that it took five reporters to uncover that Donald Trump did nothing illegal with his taxes.
Thank you, Kelly. By the way, the reporters in Russia were interviewing people who were for Trump, so they were trying to say that Russia's tied to Trump. Thank you so much, Kelly, for being with us. Coming up, Governor Nikki Haley down in South Carolina, slow to support Donald Trump, but now says she is voting for him. Our next guest says every working American needs to follow her lead because only elites can afford another Clinton White House. Steve Hilton's warning to the working class.
We have got some quick Wednesday morning headlines for you right now. He died at the hands of terrorists in Benghazi after Hillary Clinton stalled on sending more security that he requested. And now this is what happens if you try and donate to her campaign on Ambassador Chris Stevens' behalf. It blocks you. But if you donate for Osama bin Laden, the site goes right through. Great.
And serving up a cup of controversy, Starbucks' new Unity Cup sparking outrage just days before the election. The new green design features more than 100 people, as you can see right there, drawn with a single line. But some are accusing Starbucks of political brainwashing and spreading liberal bias. There you go. Brian.
All right, Steve. It's in a huge change of heart. One of Donald Trump's most prominent critics recently revealed why she'll be voting for Donald Trump after all.
This is no longer a choice for me on personalities because I'm not a fan of either one. What it is about is policy. The best person based on the policies and dealing with things like Obamacare still is Donald Trump. That doesn't mean it's an easy vote. But it does mean that I'm watching out for the people of South Carolina, and I'm watching out for the people of this country, and that's who I will be voting for on November 8th.
Wow. Our next guest says this is the lesson to every working American, building off what the governor just said. Here to explain is CrowdPak CEO and former advisor to UK Prime Minister David Cameron, Steve Hilton. Steve, you wrote a column about this, building off the Nikki Haley quote. Why?
Because I think that it goes to the heart of the choice that people have to make in the election, which is, what are going to be the real world consequences of the outcome for real people? If you look at what the Clinton campaign are doing, basically the whole campaign along, they've just been saying, don't vote for Trump because of his personal behavior. You saw even yesterday where she wheels out Miss Universe. There's no argument.
From Venezuela.
That's right. There's no argument about his policies, about his tax plan, his support for school choice, any of that stuff. It's just his personal behavior means he can't be president. Now, if you're rich, you can afford to take that view, because to be honest, if you have a President Clinton and the Democrats and more of the same economic stagnation, it doesn't really affect you. Your life is going to be fine. But if you're a working American who's really struggling to pay the bills, you don't find the job opportunities there, you're worried about the future for your kids, you can't afford to have four more years of the same economic stagnation. And that's why you've got to put the real impact before personal behavior and really look at policy.
You're the professional politico, but if I'm a candidate and I hired you to finish off my campaign, and my best closing argument is how bad the other guy is, I think I'm a failed candidate. It's all they're talking about is how thin-skinned, he doesn't pay taxes, and look at how he views women.
It's really embarrassing if you think about the fact that this is a person, Hillary Clinton, who's basically been plotting and scheming for this for 30 years. And right a few days before her big moment, she hasn't got a single inspiring message about the change that she will bring to real people's lives. She's just slagging off the other guy. It's really kind of embarrassing. And I think when people think about, well, when I come and vote and I really have to think about the impact of my vote on real life, that is the key, crucial factor.
So many people looked at Donald Trump and say, just prove yourself electable. And he kept tripping himself up. For the last 2.5 weeks, all he does is talk about policy. He was getting cheers on policy yesterday and barely brought up emails. Fascinating as we look to see the close of this campaign, where most national polls have it within 2 points.
It's exactly right, because all along, right from the beginning, when Trump has been talking about the issues and about real change in real people's lives, he does well. And so when you have, like we saw a headline in the New York Times not long ago, which is, how could anyone vote for Trump?
Yeah, you write that in your column, how could anyone vote for Trump? And you come back is that really your best argument for voting for Clinton?
That's right, how could anyone vote for Trump? Because they don't want to, they literally can't understand how anyone could support a candidate with those personal characteristics. But that's because they don't want to engage in the real argument about what difference is going to be the result of voting for Trump versus Clinton on the economy, on schools, on healthcare, where he's got the message of change. And all she's saying is basically you're going to end up with more of the same, which has left the rich richer, but half of America earning less today than about 15 years ago.
Who would think a month ago we'd be talking 6 days out, we still don't know who's going to win? But that is exactly the case. Steve Hilton, great to see you. Good job. All right, coming up straight ahead, and we have a Fox News alert, and it's not good news. Breaking right now, two cops ambushed, shot dead in their patrol cars, two separate attacks. Brand new details just coming in from an emotional press conference with the chief of police. And World Series ratings are surging for the first time in a long time as NFL ratings are tanking. Many blaming the national anthem protests and a great matchup in baseball. What does the host of Fox NFL Sunday, Mr. Everything, Kurt Menefee, think? We're going to find out. We put a mic on him. I hope he talks.
Every 4 years, America chooses its next leader. And this time, the country makes its most critical decision yet.
Nobody can solve problems better than we can.
A movement like they've never, ever seen.
I want to be the president for everybody.
On November 8th. America's comeback begins.
And it's all been leading up to this. The world is watching as America chooses its next commander-in-chief. And only one team gets you every angle, all day and all night as the votes roll in. Breaking down every state.
There and the families of those officers. By the way, we don't know their identities just yet. But we are getting new details about the two police officers who were killed overnight in Iowa. They were murdered while sitting in their squad cars. The suspect still on the run, free to kill again. This happened just outside of Des Moines near a high school. In two separate locations, the shootings occurred 20 minutes apart. Fellow officers visibly shaken.
In all appearances, it looks just like that these officers were ambushed. It doesn't look like there was any interaction between these officers and whoever the coward is that shot them while they sat in their cars. That's the best we got that we can explain the scene right now. Both of them were in their cars.
Wow, this happened at 1:06 a.m. Central Time. Multiple law enforcement agencies are now involved in a massive manhunt at this hour. It is a breaking story. We're just getting in information, and we will bring you all the latest as the details continue to unfold. Customers bracing for gas prices to spike after a deadly pipeline explosion we first told you about yesterday. Alabama now under a state.
For religion to forgive and try to understand.
6 days to go. President Obama has been out on the campaign trail trying to get people excited to vote for Hillary Clinton and hyping the economy that he has overseen for the last 8 years.
We turned job losses into 15 million new jobs. Poverty went down faster than any time since 1968. We've seen an America that went from too many people uninsured to now 20 million people with health care who didn't have it before.
Okay, well, he's making things sound pretty good, right? Is it really as rosy as the president is painting it? And what's it going to mean for your wallet if she wins? Brian Brenberg is the chairman of business and finance at the King's College here in New York City. Well, Brian, you just heard the president. That sounds great. Is it accurate?
He's telling one part of the story, but he's conveniently leaving out a few things. He's leaving out the growth in debt. He's leaving out the number of long-term unemployed, people stuck in part-time jobs. He's leaving out the number of people who've dropped out of the labor force. He's leaving out food stamp enrollment. There's another side of the story that he's not telling here.
But he did mention health care. But health care, I don't know if I would be touting that.
I wouldn't be talking about that right now. The premium increases, the deductible increases, insurers dropping out of the market. That's the bad news story that's been added to the last 7 years of a difficult economy that's really got people thinking about what do I want to see over the next 4 years.
Yeah. When you look at, I heard Mrs. Clinton say yesterday, my plans don't add a penny to the deficit. Here's some of the stuff on her wish list right now. $350 billion for tuition-free college, sounds great. $275 billion for infrastructure, sounds great. $300 billion for family leave. $60 billion for clean energy, although we've spent plenty on that, and that hasn't worked out so well. What do you think about that?
Well, she says she's going to raise taxes by about $1.5 trillion on the wealthy to pay for that. But you know what? That doesn't even handle the deficits that she's already going to inherit. The debt's going to increase by over $9 trillion on her watch. So it's not good enough just to pay for your new spending. You have to pay for the fact that we have all this built-in spending from things like Obamacare that are going to send the debt way up over the next 10 years.
And ultimately, don't you think she's going to have to wind up raising taxes and it's going to wind up
everybody? You can't balance that budget on the backs of the rich. They're simply not going to pay for it. They're going to find other ways to invest their money. So I think the likelihood is the middle class is going to pay for this one way or the other.
Sure. And we heard earlier in the program, we ran a soundbite where she said, if you know somebody who's going to vote for Donald Trump, you need to stage an intervention. And then she went through the litany of how he used the tax rules to his advantage. Those are the rules.
Yeah, you know, when you're going to go after somebody for playing by the rules, I don't think you've got a winning argument there. They should be talking about the policy issues. Who's going to grow this economy over the next 4 years? I don't think more government spending, I don't think higher taxes is a route to do that.
All right. Professor, thank you very much for joining us.
Always good to see you.
All right. Thank you, sir. All right. Coming up, stunning new developments. After email show 10 hack attacks on Hillary Clinton's illegal server in just 2 days. 10 in 2. Lieutenant General Michael Flynn is furious. He joins us in 10 minutes. Then Governor Scott Walker facing a firestorm of controversy for this tweet. Carly Shimkus here with why people think Walker just endorsed Hillary. But did he?
I love that guy that flips.
The internet goes wild when a tweet from one of Hillary Clinton's strongest critics is interpreted as an endorsement for Hillary Clinton.
Yep, here with a breakdown of what's trending this morning. Fox News headlines 24/7, key reporter. Ooh. XM 115 is where you find her.
I
for
like
right
that.
Now, she's with us. Carly
like
Shimkus, welcome back.
Carly.
We got to find out what's happening in Wisconsin. What's going on?
Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker's anti-Clinton tweet backfired in a big way. So he tried to make a case for voters to vote for Donald Trump. He tweeted, "If you like the past 8 years, vote Hillary Clinton." Well, the problem is a lot of people thought he was endorsing Clinton in that tweet. Chris Jackson writes, "This is going to be your most popular tweet, but not in the way you hoped." Evan says, "I didn't know who Scott Walker was, and as soon as I saw that tweet, I thought he was an HRC supporter." And Kevin tweets, "I'm Scott Walker, and I'm confused by this message."
It is
not a good one.
It is a little confusing. Maybe there are people out there who liked the last 8 years, and so they would think
a lot of Democrats responded to that tweet and said, "Thank you for the tip." So I don't think that's what he was
looking for. And apparently, we are not the only ones that like the Wawa.
Wawa.
The food at Wawa. Donald Trump.
The coffee.
His daughter, Tiffany.
Yeah, picture this. You're standing in a Wawa doing some of your normal shopping, crossing off the shopping list, when in walks in Donald Trump, his daughter, Tiffany, and legendary Indiana basketball coach, Bobby Knight.
Amazing.
Apparently, he didn't buy anything, but he stopped to take some pictures. Those pictures are going viral online. Other members of his entourage, though, reportedly picked up some tasty cakes.
Wait a minute. You're saying they went in, they didn't buy anything. They just went window shopping at Wawa?
Donald Trump didn't buy anything personally. You know, you always look for what the candidate's going to buy.
All right.
And you, go ahead.
I was going to say from Wawa back to Wisconsin.
Wawa to Wisconsin.
Tim Kaine, with one comment, could have lost the election in that state for his woman.
He made a crucial error. He asked a reporter, "What's a cheese curd?"
Oh.
That's like asking a reporter in Pennsylvania, "What's a cheese steak?"
Right.
You gotta know your food on the campaign trail. So Tim Kaine responded to the reporter who tweeted about it, saying, "We didn't have cheese curds growing up in Kansas City, but man, have I been missing out."
Oh, trying to redeem himself.
Now, this story does have a happy ending, though, because he was spotted at a restaurant later that day eating cheese curd.
Of course he
with
was.
With radish, with a horseradish.
Well,
which I've never had a cheese
was.
Curd with a horseradish before.
You can get it at Wawa.
I guess so.
Well, so what's the theory then? The theory is know what's indigenous to the people of that state.
Remember
that
when
would be smart.
Yes.
Sure. Remember when John Kerry was down in Philly and he went to either Geno's or Pat's and he ordered a cheesesteak and he asked for
a
Swiss cheese.
Oh,
on it.
And he called it a sub, I think, not a hoagie.
Oh, he did.
Oh, man, it was just a catastrophe.
There should be somebody in your campaign completely dedicated to teaching you the food of that area because always becomes a big viral topic if you get it wrong.
All right. When in New York, do not eat the pizza with
a fork.
Exactly right.
Exactly.
All right. Carly, thank you very
and
much.
And know what pizza is if you're coming to New York.
Exactly. And how to pronounce it. Hey, guess who's coming up next? You see them all the time introducing Donald Trump at his live events. Now he's going to be with us in studio. How do I know? I recognize the hall. He is Lieutenant General Michael Flynn, and he is here live.
Come on over. I just want to hear that ringtone. I like it turned up when you're blowing up my phone. Want to hear you say, come on over. Because when you tell me to come on over, I like the sound of that.
Morning, it's Wednesday. It's November 2nd, 2016. I'm Ainsley Earhart. We start with a Fox News alert. Two police officers ambushed overnight, shot dead while they were just sitting in their patrol cars in two different locations. A manhunt is now underway for a killer. The breaking details in just moments.
Meanwhile, 6 days until the election, and the ghosts of Bill Clinton's past just came back to haunt him and haunt Hillary as well in a brand new October surprise. This one on the first day of November. Not from WikiLeaks, but this one from the FBI.
Plus, Donald Trump has a new message for America. It is not too late to change your mind and your vote.
This is a good time to make an important public service announcement. You can change your vote to Donald Trump. We'll make America great again, okay?
All right, we're live and on the campaign trail to talk more about that, because your mornings are better because you chose to watch with friends.
Fox News alert this morning, a cold-blooded cop killer on the run at this hour after shooting two police officers in Iowa, sparking fears that more officers will be murdered. Both officers were just sitting helplessly in their patrol cars in two separate locations.
Yep, the shootings just happened 20 minutes apart near a high school just outside Des Moines. One of the patrol cars was riddled with bullets.
I actually used to live three blocks away from where one of those police officers were shot. Now, their fellow officers, while visibly shaken, vowing to find the dangerous killer who is still, at this hour, on the run.
In all appearances, it looks just like that these officers were ambushed. On the surface right now, just like I said, we're just a few hours into this, it doesn't look like there was any interaction between these officers and whoever the coward is that shot them while they sat in their cars. That's the best we got that we can explain the scene right now. There's definitely some danger out there. There's somebody out there shooting police officers. We hope we find him before anybody else gets hurt.
All the schools in that area, they're shut down today. Mm-hmm. Breaking details are coming in by the minute, so stay with us for the latest on this horrific story.
Let's bring in Lieutenant General Michael Flynn. You know, he's a big supporter of Donald Trump, been on the trail with him a lot. The one thing, General, that we always notice about Donald Trump, especially over the last 2 weeks, he reacts to the news.
Yeah.
And the news now is law and order.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this is an unbelievable tragedy. So you got these, you know, two great police officers that, as the, I guess the chief that just said, they were, looks like they were targeted, they were ambushed. I mean, the assault on our law enforcement professionals in this country is out of control. And I would love to see the leadership in our country today come out and say, look, this has got to end. Whoever did this particular shooting of these two great police officers, and I'll tell you, as we have gone around the country and in the, you know, in this experience that I'm, you know, having with Donald Trump, the law enforcement community is, you know, reaching out in such a big way to him because of the, you know, the compassion and frankly the support that he has shown to them to be able to say the kinds of things that we need to say. So this is just another tragedy, another example of the lack of safety that we have in our streets and our country for these police officers, my God.
You know, how did the anti-cop narrative get so loud?
Yeah, you know, I mean, it gets loud when leadership doesn't step in, okay? The anti-police narrative, the anti-law enforcement narrative, the anti-rule of law narrative gets louder when leadership does not step in. And the leadership at the local level, particularly by our chiefs of police, has been superb. It's the leadership from the White House, and you have to step in immediately when you see this.
Is it a political thing?
I don't know if it's a political thing. But what I know is that when we have police officers being ambushed and killed in the streets of our cities and our, you know, in this country, it has got to stop.
Yeah, we need to say a prayer for each of those families.
We do.
And the cops that work in that area, because this gunman's still on the loose.
Right, right.
By the way, I would love for the, just building what you said, I'd love for the president to say something.
Yeah, I would too. I mean, come on.
I would love for him to say that, listen, it doesn't matter what color you are. An attack on law and order is an attack on our society.
Right.
But let's just pivot to something about this election. With 6 days left, a couple of things happen. The FBI comes out and makes the announcement about the discovery of 650,000 emails. And then yesterday, responding to a Freedom of Information Act, they went back to 2001 and put forward documents about the Marc Rich pardon that Bill Clinton okayed. How important is that?
This just shows the continuation of the incredible dark cloud of scandals that sits over the Clinton machine. I mean, I describe this as the largest organized crime investigation probably in decades that the FBI is having to go through. You're talking about, you know, the Anthony Weiner pedophilia scandal. You're talking about the reopening of a national security investigation against Hillary Clinton, who is, you know, 4 or 5 days now away from potentially being a president. Give me a break. I mean, when is enough going to be enough for these people, in addition to the WikiLeaks, in addition to more stuff that's going to come out? I understand that, you know, there's talk about the quote-unquote 33,000 emails coming out today or tomorrow. Mm-hmm. I mean, the 33,000 are probably in the 650,000.
You're probably right.
This is unprecedented. It's unbelievable.
You know what?
You mentioned the emails,
yeah.
And we were just learning this morning, Judicial Watch recently discovered that Hillary Clinton's server was the target of 10 hack yeah. attempts in a two-day period. This was back in 2010, and the hackers were trying to log on as different people within her campaign, like Doug Bann and Uta Hagerty. What's your reaction?
Right, well, you know, all this stuff, and then the things that we are seeing in the email discussions that are coming out, I mean, even those, they're it's disgusting. This is a disgusting way to run. I mean, I would never allow this in any military organization at all. Any type of the kind of conversations that are being had in these emails is just, it's unbelievable. I would tell you that the whole effort that's going on with, when they talk about the cyber attacks and the hacking, I mean, this has been going on for many, many years. So for any of these people to be talking about what has happened or wouldn't happen, I mean, to me, this is just unbelievable. So I mean, what we're facing is an incredible level of scandal, criminal behavior. I mean, there's serious criminal behavior mm-hmm. that is directly related to Hillary Clinton's
actions.
And
that foundation?
In the foundation, I mean, everything.
You know
and
what?
It's, you know, it's funny, but it's all coming together. This 650,000, it's like Anthony Weiner is going to end up, you know, tying all this together, because he probably was using this as a get-out-of-jail-free card.
Well, apparently he is cooperating. We don't know exactly what the cooperation means.
Yeah.
But there's a story out this morning that, you know, given the fact that he was sexting, he's in big trouble for sexting with at least one underage teenager. Now there's a report that he could have been the perfect target for hacking into her server because his then wife was one of the users.
Yeah, I mean, there's two other things here that I think in my experience with investigations, which I've had quite a bit actually in the area of espionage and also just the extortion side. So you have elements here that are so dangerous for our national security, because you likely have classified information, highly classified information in this 650,000. So if Anthony Weiner had access to them, that means there are many, many other people that had access to them.
Just
President
to mention
of the United
blackmail.
States evidently
Although
had
that's
an,
the extortion.
The blackmail.
The President of the United States evidently had an alias too, and he was going back and forth with Hillary Clinton on a private server. But, General, when you talk about espionage and stuff that you've been involved in, it does bother me that we're doing this off Julian Assange's hack, because this guy's an international criminal.
Yeah.
Does it bother you?
Yeah, it bothers me. But it also, what bothers me more, it's not about Julian Assange, it's not about Russia, it's not about Anthony Weiner, it's about Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton is the one that made the decision to have an unclassified server in some closet somewhere to do government, very, very sensitive government business for 4 years.
And that's why Barack Obama should be the angriest. I hired you to do
be.
A job,
he
and you did all this. Now, here's the other thing.
He should be, but in a way, Brian, he's caught. He's caught because the leaks of information that are coming out are going to show, unless they pull them for national security reasons, they're going to show that our president was in communication with Hillary Clinton. And in fact, he said he wasn't. He said he found out about it through the media. So
sure. And with the WikiLeaks stuff, this is where we are in society with technology now.
Yeah.
This is like the whistleblower of 2016.
Yeah. That's right.
General, the other thing is that what makes this so unique, I was thinking about it this morning, is that if you didn't like Al Gore, you didn't vote for Al Gore. You don't like Bush, you don't like Bush. You didn't like Barack Obama, you didn't vote for Barack Obama. You wanted to find out more information, but it was just, let's just find out more information to find out what kind of agenda he'll have.
Right.
This is different.
Yeah,
this is what are you hiding? How deep does this go?
Yeah.
How else are you involved? What do you really mean? How are you rigging the primaries in order to get the nomination? The more you look, the uglier it gets. Like it or not, Donald Trump is so transparent. He got himself in a lot of trouble between his tweets and what he says and answering questions maybe too candidly.
Yeah,
a little too honest, you mean?
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, journalism is under attack this election for sure, because there's been so much. Frankly, there's just been deceit in your business. And I'm being very frank. This has become a social media election. And I'm telling you, you look at, so you guys pay attention to it. You report on it all the time. This is a digital election, and it has changed. And all this leak stuff,
if it's showing one thing, is that you cannot hide anything.
Yeah.
And so it's like I've said it publicly, hack my emails, because I would love to have somebody put out what I say. Because what I'm saying right here is what I say in my emails. I don't disparage people, like, you know all the kinds of words that we're hearing said in the emails.
General, there's a brand new ABC Washington Post tracking poll that has just come out in the last 10 minutes or so, and apparently on the question of honesty and trustworthiness, now Donald Trump eclipses Hillary Clinton. He's in front of her at this point, according to what was just whispered in my ear. Yeah. I got to ask you something that Mr. Trump was talking about out on the trail yesterday. Yeah. He said, look, you know, some of you may have already early voted for Hillary Clinton. It's not too late to change your vote.
Right.
How many people, as you go out, have you met or heard say, you know, I wish I could have a do-over on that?
Yeah, well, the other day.
Is this a big number we're talking about?
I don't know if it's a big number, but I think that people ought to have a, I'm glad that those states have the opportunity to show up to the polls, because I guess if you show up to the polls on polling day, if you've previously voted, you can re-vote. You can recast your vote, and I guess there's five states. I think that that's a big deal. I don't know what the numbers are going to be, but I think it's going to be very interesting to see what those numbers are, how many people re-voted.
If you look at the trends on Google, it is interesting, because no one's really checking it until the latest investigation drops on the 31st.
And all
then
sudden,
all of a sudden, a spike goes up
for
people Googling, how do you change your vote?
Right. So I think you're going to see a number of people recast their vote, and I think you're going to see it.
You can't explain it. You lived it, and you're getting briefed along with Donald Trump in many cases. But it's hard to take your eye off what's happening in the world.
Yeah.
ISIS calling for attacks on the West Coast. Mosul about to fall. We're turning this over to Iran. The challenges of what's happening in Syria. Russia on the march. China beginning to expand. When Donald Trump looks at this, does he know what he's getting into?
Yeah, he does. And it's, this is an incredibly serious time for the United States of America. And it's a very, very important time for the U.S. to demonstrate leadership. We have such a deficit of leadership right here at home and around the world, and that has got to change. And Donald Trump, that's his big message is make America great again, and his bigger message is we are going to start leading again.
Yeah, well, a week from today, next Wednesday morning, we'll know who the next president is.
That's great.
General, thank you very much.
Where are you heading now?
Back out the door.
Back on the road?
Yeah, back on the road, yeah.
Wow. Meanwhile, I know we're going. We're going straight to Election Day. Remember, 6 days from now, Fox News has Election Day covered all day. Fox and Friends is going to start at 4 a.m., and Fox News will have continuous live coverage through the nights as the votes come in. We know you want to know how every state comes in, so stay here on Fox, your official American election headquarters.
Thanks so much, General. Meanwhile, coming up straight ahead, 6 days until Election Day, and Donald Trump has a new message for America. It is not too late to change your mind.
This is a good time to make an important public service announcement. You can change your vote to Donald Trump. We'll make America great again, okay?
We are live on the campaign trail with Donald Trump. That'll be next.
Hey, hey, have you ever danced?